For these drivers, the next few moments are for quiet anticipation. For these 130,000, they are filled with suspense and a swelling wave of tension. For this man, Cale Yarborough, three-time and defending 500-mile champion, it is a peaceful time as he confidently reflects on his mount that has propelled him faster than anyone in history to the pole position for the great American race. He knows that 41 other drivers feel he's the man to beat this day in the 26th running of the Daytona 500.
Thank you, John.
Exquisite day. Welcome to the World Center of Speed for CBS Sports live flag-to-flag coverage of the million-dollar 26th annual Daytona 500. Hello, I'm Ken Squire, welcoming you back here to Daytona once again for our sixth year on CBS with this great race. The formula is simple. Man against man, the common denominator, the machine. And the machines are as all-American as the drivers themselves. Lined up down below me, 42 cars, 25 Chevrolets, 6 Fords, 5 Pontiacs, 3 Oldsmobiles, a couple of Buicks and a Chrysler, ready to do battle for some 4 hours today. Rudyard Kipling used to talk about the business of insatiable curiosity. And that's what we've seen all week. Men plumbing the mysteries of 200 miles per hour, trying to keep a car online at the very edge for 500 miles. The man who has plumbed the depths the deepest this week is the man on the pole. 201.8 miles per hour has made Cale Yarborough faster than anyone else. Standing by with him on pit road is our colleague, the two-time Grand National Champion, winner of 50 of these events, Ned Jarrett.
Good afternoon, everyone. In 1960, I qualified a race car for the Daytona 500 at 143 miles an hour. I thought that was the absolute ultimate. I didn't see how it was humanly possible to drive a car around this track any faster. Yet Cale Yarborough has done so, as Ken mentioned, at over 201 miles per hour. He looked very impressive in a qualifying race here on Thursday, pulling away in the late stages, which has prompted a lot of his colleague drivers and crew members to say that he's going to be the guy that'll set the pace here this afternoon, that will dictate what goes on. How do you feel about that?
Well, Ned, it's awful hot here today, and how we're going to run this race, I don't know yet. The racetrack is going to be awful slick, so I would like to think they are right, but I'm just going to have to wait and see how the race goes and determine then how we'll run this race.
With your style of driving, you know that they're going to have to run flat out.
Well, we're going to make a run for it, and I just hope we can put the CBS camera right in Victor Circle today.
And, of course, Cale will be carrying the CBS camera again for us. Now let's go further down pit road to Mike Joy.
Thank you, Dad. There are 25,000 stock car racers across this country. They'd all love to be right here on the starting grid for the richest race of the year. Perhaps none so much as this young gentleman, 19-year-old Bobby Hillen of Midland, Texas, starting his first Daytona 500. Last year, you came within a lap of qualifying for this race. Now you're in it, starting ahead of such legends of sport as Richard Petty and A.J. Foyt. What are your thoughts right now?
Well, I'm just super happy to be here because last year was such a letdown for me, and I thought, oh, it's going to be such a long time until I have a chance again, and now I'm here, I'm starting a race, and I couldn't be happier.
Thoughts of young Bobby Hillen about to start this Daytona 500. Back upstairs to Ken Squire.
Mike Joy has a new role this time. He'll be filling you in on attrition, bringing you resumes as the hours roll by in this 42-car field Daytona 500. Our co-host in the booth today is a man who just 2 weeks ago made some new history for a grand old mark in motorsports. The 24 Hours of Daytona, the most prestigious sports car race in the Western Hemisphere, is run here to begin Speed Weeks each February. And that 12-cylinder Jaguar, number 44, gave us memories of the 50s as David Hobbs assisted in bringing the car home in third place. It's a great pleasure to welcome the United States Trans Am champion, David Hobbs.
Thank you very much, Ken. Well, not only is Cale Yarborough on the pole at over 200 miles an hour, but the whole 42-car field assembled here has set a new record average speed at nearly 195 miles an hour. Benny Parsons said, for every mile an hour over 195, the effort doubles. Cale Yarborough himself said, sure, I can turn laps at over 200, but I need every inch of the racetrack. At 185 miles an hour, you can probably use 20 to 25 feet of racetrack through all of these turns around this 2.5-mile oval. At 195 miles an hour, that goes down to a strip of asphalt about 9 feet wide. At 200 miles an hour, it goes down to about 2.5 feet. This begs the question, how do we deal with this problem? Well, the answer is very, very carefully. The established drivers here have a vast fund of experience to draw on, but some of the short track drivers, even people like Rusty Wallace with many records of wins behind him, and people like Bobby Hillen, don't have that. What they do have is a very heavy responsibility to stay out of trouble themselves and, of course, to stay out of the way of the leaders as they come charging by at 195 miles an hour in maybe a 15 or a 20 car draft. Neil Bonnett himself said to me just this morning, boy, I sure am glad I'm not starting in Grand National Racing now, because although I'm prepared to race at any speed they tell me to, I'm kind of intimidated by these 197, 200 mile an hour speeds. So we're in for a tough race for some of those drivers, and I'm sure a very, very exciting one.
The tension and anxiety has been building all week, and most of it has developed about one section of this 2.5-mile track. It's out there, that piece of roadway known as Turn 4. In fact, it's even come up with a new name. We're delighted to bring to CBS the Dean of American Racecasters, the editor-publisher of the National Speed Sport News, will give you the story of Turn 4 this past week and what it could mean today. Here is Chris Economaki.
Thank you, Ken. Well, the headline story this week is Turn 4, which has come to be known as Calamity Corner, a turn for the worse. At speeds of up to 200 miles an hour, cars do things differently, drivers are finding out. Last Sunday, Ricky Rudd came off the turn, and then for no apparent reason, skidded out of control into the infield and almost rammed the revetment. Then on Thursday, Randy LaJoie did the same thing. His car went out of control, took off like an airplane, and slammed feet first into the revetment wall after clearing the guardrail. And then on Friday, an accident was compounded with a second car colliding with one that went out of control. An explosive fireball resulted. Miraculously, none of these drivers suffered serious injuries. But the situation is a matter of grave concern. This is the impact area. When Speed Weeks 84 began earlier this month, this steel rail was only three strands high. But after the crashes of the week, Friday night construction workers came in and doubled the height to keep cars from flying into the garage area. We asked some drivers, are they going too fast?
I know that the speed is part of what causes the problem, but speed is what we're all trying to reach. So it's kind of a two-way street. We're going fast.
When we turned off I-95 and came here to race, we came to race at whatever speed these cars were going to run. And right now the speed is 195 to 200 miles an hour. We're having to take that vehicle and go as fast as we can, as safe as we can. I don't think we need to take the 200-mile-an-hour speed away. We need to cater to the fans with some high-speed racing. We just got to get these cars where they're controllable. You're paying a severe price off this corner just because of the way that abutment sticks out.
There's a bump coming off of turn number four when the car unloads itself coming out of turn four. You hit that little bump, and it just gets the car airborne, and it turns it around, and then when it turns it around, the wind gets under the car and in the car and just makes it go sailing. The bottom line is speed. You know, we're just running faster than we've ever run before, and that bump over there is upsetting the cars more than it ever has before.
While there may not be agreement on speed, one thing is certain. For the drivers, Calamity Corner is this year's concern. Ken?
Thank you, Chris. It was just 7 days ago that Ricky Rudd took that series of sidewinders out of turn four. Since then, he has returned to the track He is qualified, and his car rests now 14th on the grid. You'll meet Ricky Rudd after these messages.
Special is sponsored by Pontiac. Cars that tell the world you're not just along for the ride. Pontiac, we build excitement. Budweiser, for all you do, this Bud's for you. Skoal Bandits, for tobacco pleasure without lighting up. It's a pouch instead of a puff. And by Union Oil, the winning spirit rides with you every time. It's the spirit of 76.
Live at Daytona, we are just minutes away from a very special command to fire the engines today. What sustains a driver through those dreadful moments when his car is out of control and then makes him come back just 7 days later to the greatest race of them all? Here's Mike Joy with Ricky Rudd.
Well, Ken, this is not the same race car that Ricky Rudd flipped Sunday. Race cars are replaceable. Fellas like these are not. You look like you've been in a gang fight and your gang didn't show. How do you feel today?
Well, Mike, I feel like I've been worked over pretty good. Each day I get a little bit stronger, and today I feel pretty good. I'm just a little bit lightheaded. Besides that, a few aches and pains, and that's about the limit of it.
Have you taken any special precautions to prevent any recurrence or any further injury to yourself while you're in the car today?
Well, I have. I've gotten with some sports trainers, and I've got a football flak jacket type of deal on. It's just basically fiberglass with some padding inside of it to protect my rib protection in case I bang any more walls. It also helps hold me together a little bit better to keep the muscles inside from hurting so bad.
You've not seen the videotape of what happened Sunday. I understand you don't care to.
No, I don't really care to. Maybe in a couple of years I'll look at it. I understand it's quite spectacular, and I really am fortunate, and I realize that I'm very lucky, but right now I've got 500 miles of racing in front of me, and I don't care about seeing it since I really don't remember it as it is right now.
Ricky Rudd about to climb in his car. Back to you, Ken Squire.
Every year since its 1959 inception, the Daytona 500 has been the petty story. In all, Richard, his father, and Pete Hamilton collected 9 wins here in this race. The petties are again a story in 1984. But it is a far different story about Richard Petty than ever before. For no longer is Richard Petty a member of Petty Enterprises. The red, white, and blue livery is still there. But it's a far different team. Here's Ned Jarrett.
It is a far different team this year, Ken, than we've seen Richard Petty in the past, although he's won 7 of these Daytona 500s. Richard, how about this one today?
Well, it's going to be a little bit different. We're starting way back in the back, as furthest back we started. And, you know, we've been behind all year since we started trying a new team. And right now, we've been in worse shape, really, a lot of times down here and won the race. So we're hoping that this is one of the good days, that we've had a really bad week leading up to the race and then have a good day today.
It's only been a couple of weeks since you went to this situation that you have. You had to quickly put a crew together. Have you had time to introduce them to each other, let alone get practice up for the pit work here today?
Well, really, we jumped into the deal and hired a couple of boys right quick, and then the rest of them has come on board. In fact, a couple of them just went to work for us down here. But we've been out in the infield doing some practicing, and as far as pit stops, and, you know, in a 125-mile race, they got a couple of pit stops in, so I think it'll be all right today.
Of course, your son Kyle will be in this Daytona 500 here today. I know that you'll have one eye sort of watching what's going on with him. He's now the number one driver for Petty Enterprises. How do you see his performance?
Well, really, I think they're in super good shape. You know, they left the whole operation over to him, and the boys that he's had working for him and stuff, they put a car together that's really sharp, probably the best-looking car down here. And, you know, with his little experience and their little experience, they're going to gain a little bit more today. But I think it'll be all right. I'm really got a lot of confidence in it.
Well, fans, you can expect the Petty name to be in synonymous in auto racing for a long time to come. Now let's go to Ken Squire with the starting grid.
Ladies and gentlemen, the starting grid for the 1984 Daytona 500. In the front row, the three-time winner from South Carolina, Cale Yarborough, and beside him, Texas, Terry Labonte. In row two, it's the Ford, number 9 of Bill Elliott, and beside him, the Buick of the two-time Daytona winner, Bobby Allison. Row three, the fastest 500-mile race in history was won by Buddy Baker. Next to him, Harry Gantt. Going to row four, Neil Bonnet has the inside groove, and on the outside, the 1975 winner, Benny Parsons. Row five, it's Jeff Bodine from the state of New York and Ohio's Tim Richmond. Going to row six, 1976 Daytona winner, David Pearson and Richard Brooks, car 90. Going to row seven, Rookie candidate Phil Parsons, the number 66, and the victim of a terrible crash just a week ago, Ricky Rudd. Row 8, it's Kyle Petty on the inside, and beside him, Mississippi's Lake Speed. In row 9, Ken Reagan, number 77, and Massachusetts' Ron Bouchard. In row 10, three-time USAC champion Dean Roper and New York State's Greg Sachs. Row 11 is Dick Trickle, the great Midwestern star, and from Texas, Bobby Hillett Jr. Going to row 12, Doug Hebron is there alongside the Virginian Lenny Pond. In row 13, Dean Combs, number 97, and Darrell Waltrip still trying to win his first Daytona 500. Going to row 14, Rusty Wallace with new colors this year, and beside him, Buddy Arrington. Row 15 is Dale Earnhardt and McKeesport, Pennsylvania's Tommy Gale. Row 16 from Upland, California, third 2 years ago, fourth last year, Joe Ruttman and the great A.J. Foyt. In row 17, it's Jody Ridley and the seven-time winner of the Daytona 500, Richard Petty. Row 18, Calgary, Alberta, Canada's Trevor Boyce and car number 29, Connie Saylor. In row 19, it's Quack Dwyer and Ronnie Thomas of Christiansburg, Virginia. In row 20, Dave Marcus, the Wisconsin campaigner, and Sterling Marlin. Going to row 21, from Alabama comes Jimmy Smut Means, and a new face on the Grand National Trail from Tennessee, Mike Alexander. 130,000 people await the start of the Great American Race. The invocation has just been given by the Reverend Ralph Marchman of the Central Baptist Church, Daytona Beach, and in just a moment, the national anthem will be sung by Scott Weidenmiller of Daytona Beach, Florida. All 42 drivers are now in their car, ready for the start of the Daytona 500.
Daytona Beach, Scott Weidenmiller, and the raising of the United States flag by the Embry-Riddle Aeronautical University Army ROTC.
A very special command today to fire these engines and get the second quarter century of the Daytona 500 underway. Here is Scott Weidenmiller.
Can you see by the dawn's early sky what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleam, whose bush red and bright stars through the perilous fight, for the ramparts we watch were so gallantly. And the rockets reclare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wear for the land of the free and the
to it. Here is Chris Economaki.
Junior, there's one statement that everyone agrees to in this business, that to win you have to have a team. Now, your team has taken a rap yesterday when the crew chief for Neil Bonnett was sent to the hospital. You've moved into that crew chief's role. Is that going to be a problem for Bonnett in number 12 today?
Well, that don't do him any good from a standpoint of making the pit stops. Because Doug was our right front tire changer, and he's one of the quickest they are in the business, and losing him definitely a blow to our team, but we're moving a boy into it. He has done it before. He's just a little bit slower, I think, but he'll do a good job for us, and I'm going to call all the shots on the car, which I have done a lot in the past, so we won't be all, you know, that bad of shape. We just weren't geared for this, really.
Okay, but on the other car, you had to change engines at the last minute. Are these worries to you, Junior?
Not really. The reason I changed the engine in the other car was it was my decision. The engine had a little noise in it that I didn't like, and when I hear that, I've said, well, maybe it'll go away, and it don't go away. It gets worse, so when I hear it anymore, that decision's already made. I changed motors.
What did Darrell say about the engine change?
Well, he understands and he agrees with what I do on the car, because them kind of decisions can come home to, you know, haunt you later on. And you don't question them. You just make the decision and live with it.
Okay, thank you very much, Junior. Ken?
It was one day ago that Doug Richard was working for Neil Bonnet on pit road. Struck by another car, he broke his left leg and his ankle. Also, his nose was broken, and he is watching from the Halifax Hospital here in Daytona Beach rather than being on pit road. One of the youngest crew chiefs in the history of Grand National Racing, Doug Richard is not here today. And now the President of the United States.
Start your engine.
Thank you.
The President of the United States from the White House giving the command to fire the engine for the 26th annual Daytona 500. Pole sitter's car, Cale Yarborough. And now, ladies and gentlemen, from the 34th position, you are inside the car of the king, chewing on a rag as he always does, Richard Petty.
He said he'd try not to do that today, but he had to carry on.
Keeps his lips moist.
That is one of the problems with driving racing cars, especially on a hot day, is you do dry out, and if you do dry out, if your mouth goes dry, it's an awful feeling.
There is Jeff Bodine, Kenny Rogers' car, car number 5, Bodine with new colors this year, anxious as everyone for the start of the 1984 Daytona 500. And now you are looking down pit road at a 200 mile per hour front row. Yarborough, 201 plus miles per hour. And beside him, Texas Terry Labonte.
Flagman there showing 2 laps.
The field rolling out. Richard Petty has said, it ain't the money nor the glory. I just like to drive. Some cats, they like to watch cows eat grass. That's their thing. Me, I like to drive. It's my thing. I like the feel of metal around me. The feel of tires. The Daytona 500 in a moment. Pontiac of Richard Petty now, number 43, as they move through the first and second turn down on the apron of the track. There you see the 31-degree banking. It gives you some idea of just how steep those banks are. They'll be hellhounding at over 190, close to 200 miles per hour. He's now down the back straightaway. Richard Petty, this is Ken Squire at CBS Control. Can you hear us, Richard? Richard Petty? Okay. How do you feel right now? Richard? How do you feel right now as you pull up beside Joe Ruttman on this start? Let's try Cale Yarborough, who sits on the pole at 201 plus miles an hour, the Waddell Wilson car, which has been there 5 of the last 6 years. Car number 28. A clear view for Cale, coming down by the grandstand for the first of the 2 preliminary laps. Cale Yarborough, as you come down to the start-finish line of the Tri-Oval, you're on the point for this race. Someday, some say you don't intend just to lead this event, but you intend to conduct this thing like an orchestra. You're going to stay there all day.
Well, I don't know about that. I've been running good all week. I'm just going to take a look at the race and see what it looks like. If I can run out front comfortably, I might. If they can lay back, I just have to wait and see.
How do you feel right now as you approach turn number 1 and know the next time you head in there, it means business? Have a good one, Cale. Last year, he carried our CBS camera to victory in this event, pulled into victory lane. Just remarkable pictures. The argument before a race is always who gets to talk last. Last year, Cale said, I'll take the camera and I'll take the audio part, but only if you let me describe the start.
Huh. Well, he's right that the winner of today's race certainly is going to have his work cut out. The average speed is absolutely staggering. The slowest car turning in lap speeds are very close to 192. 191.95 is close enough to 192 for me. And, of course, Cale on the pole at 201.8.
And he says that in years to come, he could go 203, 205. There's a report on the conditions, near perfect for the start. Wind not a factor today, the temperature's about right. It may be just warm enough, however, to get that track slippery before too much longer.
Well, I think it will get the track slippery, and I think the track itself has got slippery as the week has progressed because there's been very little rain this week.
And you are now with Neil Bonnett, giving us a little wave out of car number 12. Neil Bonnett, who has never won this race, won the World 600 last year, then went on, starting in seventh position, to win the Atlanta Journal 500. You will be riding with Richard Petty out of 34th position. We get ready for a go here. Neil Bonnett is starting in the seventh position, a major dark horse to win his first Daytona 500 today.
Now you're in for a thrill of a minute. If you're going to be in Richard Petty's car from the back of this field, you're going to get a real feel of the dust and dirt, debris, and the cars around you. There, the pace car pulls off.
Coming for green. By the crowd, standing on their feet. You're inside the pole car. You see the green flag flying. They are away. The 1984 Daytona 500 is underway. Yarborough to the point of turn one. Labonte comes to second. 165, 170, about 180 miles per hour now. Inside, Bill Elliott trying to draw a bead on first watch. He falls back.
Elliott being swamped on the back straight there.
Buddy Baker up on the inside. There are your two leaders for turn three. 195 plus miles an hour now as they go into turn three. The critical turn, Calamity Corner. Complete. Yarborough on the point. 42 cars. And you're looking out the back window of Cale Yarborough's car. At better than 190 miles per hour around the banking of the west end of the Speedway. Terry Labonte right there.
Absolutely right there.
Backstretch. Third and fourth place cars overhauling one and two. Down they go for the third turn. Passing area. Richard Petty is on the move. Here he comes up on the rookie, Phil Parsons, in 66. Takes him on the high side.
Coming up to the troublesome corner. This is the just about to go over the tunnel, and I'm sure you'll see the car bounce and see Richard's hands move there as he pulls past Benny Parsons. Phil Parsons.
He pulls up on Ron Bouchard now in front of him. Battle for the lead. Down into turn one. Give it to Terry Labonte. As they work back three, Labonte is in first. Bobby Allison, defending national champion, last lap, 196.5 miles an hour.
Well, if they keep that up, we're going to have a lot of airtime at the end of this race.
Fastest 500 has been an average speed of 177 miles an hour. New leader, Cale Yarborough.
Terry Labonte took the lead away from him for a bit there, but Bobby Allison lying there in third spot, hanging on. People.
There's Darrell Waltrip. He's trying to win his first 500. His car and Bonnett's, identical colors. Leaders. Harry Gant lies fourth. Going fifth is Buddy Baker. Chevrolet running one and two on the field. Buick running third. Straight away.
And in 17th spot already is Richard Petty.
Blown engine in turn one. A car sliding in turn one at the bottom of the racetrack. Spinning. It's 75. It's the Raymond car with Dave Marcus. Dave Marcus, who took over. Petty was going to drive that car this year as part of this great change going on in the Petty dynasty. And Dave Marcus, many said he was the dark horse to do it all. Blows an engine in the first turn.
Well, at this stage of the race, with so many cars together, that all got away with that pretty cleanly. He just put a lot of oil down there, so they'll be out there with the trucks.
That happened in the third lap. They were working the fourth lap, excuse me, in the fourth lap, when Marcus loses an engine in turn number one.
Lost an engine now, of course, he lost a tire, and that terrific slide. He didn't come in contact with the wall.
Let's take a look in replay here at the car that had started in 39th position for the 1984 Daytona 500. Here he comes. Engine had gone before he came to the turn one area of this 2.5 mile tri-oval.
And in that smoke screen, there's another car. Glad he's not there, not me. There you see him come down, hits that flat apron, manages to hold the car down there. In fact, it was AJ Foyt. Is that 14?
Indeed it was. AJ coming out of that one unscathed. But for Dave Marcus, this million-dollar race is over. The Raymock team's number 75 out of competition.
You see the car there lifted up as it hit the banking again and started to turn it up, but it got back on all four again.
Let's go to the pits. Here's Chris Economek.
So there are no statistics to back it up. Old-timers say that today is the hottest Daytona 500 Sunday since the race began 26 years ago, and that could become a factor as the race wears on. Now down pit road to Ned Jarrett.
Chris, I'm standing by with Jeff Hammond, the crew chief on Darrell Waltrip's car, and we mentioned in the top of the broadcast that they had to change the engines on that car this morning. Jeff, any indication how it's doing?
So far, Ned, I just got off the radio with Darrell. He said all the gauges indicate everything's fine. The motor seems to be running rather well. The car seems like it's handling rather well. He's just got to, you know, lay back a little bit now and work his way up through traffic so he can catch up with these leaders and see how things go as the day progresses.
You folks didn't seem to be too discouraged, the fact that you had to change that engine.
No, we've got a lot of confidence in our engine as a whole, and we've had to do this in the past. And, we've had real good results with it. As a matter of fact, the last couple of times we've had to change motors on race morning, we went on to win the race. So, you know, kind of deep down inside, we're kind of hoping that that condition doesn't...
Well, your boss man, Junior Johnson, of course, had to fill in for your counterpart, Doug Richard, today. Any word from down there? Or you're strictly on your own, I assume?
Yes, sir. I got... all the guys here in the pits are going to be here to support me, and I've got Darrell on the other end. Plus, I got one of Junior's good friends, Banjo Matthews, back here with a lot of years of experience to kind of help me out if I do need a little bit of a consultation as far as that's concerned. But we've been doing it the last couple of years. Darrell and I have been working real close together with the car and the pit crew and everything, so we believe we'll be all right, and hopefully won't get in too bad of a bind today. And I want to wish Doug a real speedy recovery, and we're all thinking about him.
Everyone is thinking about it, Ken. They seem to be well organized, even though they had that catastrophe yesterday.
Doug Heverin on pit road. A.J. Foyt made a brief pit stop. Dave Marcus brings out the first caution. He's fallen out of 7 of the last 9 Daytona 500s. More in a moment. Now working in the 7th of the 200 laps in the Daytona 500 for 1984. There you see the little leaderboard. There is Sterling Marlin on pit road, as Cale Yarborough has stayed out in front. Terry Labonte's given him a good ride. Bobby Allison is right in there with him, going in the third position. Harry Gant, who showed surprising strength in the 125-mile qualifiers on Thursday, is fourth. It's Buddy Baker with the Wood Brothers car, still in the fifth position. Benny Parsons is sixth. Richard Brooks is in seventh as they line up. In the eighth position now, it is the Bill Elliott car, and in ninth, at the present time, Neil Bonnet. Let's go to Junior Johnson, who's standing by on pit road.
Junior, Dow's pit's about 100 yards down the road here. How do you communicate back and forth to keep in touch with what's going on?
Well, we don't right now. The radios that I have should pick up Darrell and Jeff when they're talking, but they got their hand full, I got mine full. We just do the best we can with the teams the way they're separated right now. They'll make all the decisions there, and I'll make them here.
Junior, people that have been here a while say this is the hottest Daytona 500 Sunday they can remember. Will this be a factor in today's race?
They'll definitely be a factor. I think the cars that is not a handling real good will start showing up somewhere around 200 or 300 miles, and you'll see some guy that just accidentally hit the right combination go away from the rest of them.
About that. Okay, Ken.
Darrell Waltrip is now 21st on the field, running 21st as they come around for at least one more lap of caution.
I think the heat could be a factor for the drivers here too, because in the winter, these guys, of course, drive in the worst conditions in the world. The southeastern states and the states, of course, are tremendously hot in the summer when they build up to it. But they're a bit out of practice for that sort of thing, and normally this is a pretty cool race. and they're going to get hot today, very hot.
I can remember in the late 60s, in 67, when Mario Andretti won this race, it was a scorcher, and I believe in 69 when Leroy Yarborough won this race, it was also a day equal to this. Doug Heverin is back on pit road. We can take a look at a race analysis here as we watch Doug Heverin having problems in his first go out here. Doug Heverin, there's the race analysis at the present time. 42 cars started today for a purse of $1,200,000. The record for 500 miles, 177 for Buddy Baker in 1980. Here's Ned Jarrett with Dave Marcus.
The first driver out of the race is Dave Marcus. Dave, I think that look on your face tells the story. Very disgusting.
Ned, it is. It's, you know, we were really running good all week long. We had a misfortune in the 125. I got a black flag because I jumped on a restart and we were running fourth. But the car is, all week long, we've been able to draft with anybody, run 197, 198, and this car's just, it's just the best race car, really, that I've had on this racetrack, I think, since I've been here in 76 with the Dodge, and it's very disappointing, because I really felt like we could get up front and we had a chance to win this race.
Who do you like out there? Do you have any picks of those that are left out there as to who might be the man to beat?
Well, I know Cale's running good, Ned, but you know, I still think the Monte Carlos are going to be tough to keep tight during the race at speeds, and I'd have to say that Bobby's car is, I ran with him yesterday, he's very comfortable, he's very tight, he showed that in the 125 is where he really beat the guys who through the corners. They'd run back up on him down at the end of the straightaways, but when they got there, they were so loose they couldn't make that pass. I'm sure they had the power and everything like that to do it, but Bobby's car was working good, he was sticking, and I would say that he's the guy because his car, I know, is very comfortable. I ran with him yesterday afternoon, and I told these fellows, Bob and Butch, I said, our car and Bobby's, them are the two cars you're going to see leading this race today.
Well, Kent, that's an interesting situation. We'll have to keep our eye on that.
Well, Dave Marcus out in three laps, and it's some of those days you just wonder why he bothered to get up.
Richard Petty has been on the move from 34th to 16th before the caution flag came out, and there you see him with the car number 43. Buddy Parrott, crew chief on the car. They'll now move their shop to Kannapolis, North Carolina, some 60 miles from Level Cross, where the Petty Racing Organization has called home since the very beginning, back in 1948 with Lee Petty. From the Goodyear blimp, you're getting these pictures of the cars up on the banking. Give you a feeling for the 31 degrees of this track. The Goodyear blimp Enterprise out of Pompano Beach, Florida, showing you this vast expanse, this largest crowd in the history of the Southeast. Pilot Captain Patrick Henry from Parsons, West Virginia. Down behind, Lake Lloyd moves the field, and green will be shown this time by. They will take green as they complete nine laps.
An early caution like that, I can't help but feel, must be very disruptive to a driver's train of thought. You've really built yourself up all morning, and for Dave Marcus to fall out, it's really, the anticlimax is terrible. But these guys have been pumping themselves up for the last 2 weeks. To have a green a caution flag at the end of the third lap is a little bit disruptive, so I hope they get off to a good clean start, which of course will be single file, because as yet nobody has been lapped. Which is one of the things that got Dave Marcus into trouble during the qualifying race, when he did in fact make a second mile.
Pace car is in. Neil Bonnet buys ninth. Coming down, Harold Kinder. Caution him, holding him about 60, 65 miles per hour. There's the green flag, and from the Goodyear blimp, you see them come through the trioval across the start-finish line.
And Kyle Petty and his father, absolutely side by side. They both jumped out of line there.
And there goes Rusty Wallace in the white and green car down at the bottom of the track. Rusty Wallace, victim of a terrible crash here, number 88 a year ago. Now you're with Richard Petty. He takes Bouchard, and he's going after car number 15, Ricky Rudd, the 13th position on the back straightaway. Terry Labonte out in front of Cale Yarborough. Not for long. Cale Yarborough back in first.
Yarborough seems to have the ability to just streak by these guys at the end of that back street, straight going into turn three and four, and to maintain it around the rest of the track.
Out of four, 41 cars still in contention. Allison third, Baker fourth, Neil Bonnet moves to fifth, Harry Gant drops to sixth. There you see Richard Petty on the inside. Now notices his car in, single file into turn one.
Well, he's running about 16th where he was before. I think we're going to see a thing here where about that top 15 or 16 cars is probably going to break away.
Now Bouchard has moved back by Richard Petty, the number 47 car, back with the leaders. I'll tell you what was surprising, that last picture was Ken Reagan out of Unadilla, Georgia, number 77, right on Petty's rear bumper, and this is only his 16th Grand National race. There you see him, the 77, that's Ken Reagan. He's a car dealer from Unadilla, Georgia, was a kart racer, I mean go-kart, not any type cars. He's made the switch into these big cars, and he looks very smooth. He has all week long here at this 2.5 mile track.
He's the sort of driver that could have worried some of the established drivers here, but he doesn't seem to have done it. He took very smoothly, as you say, all the week. And, of course, he's been turning in some cracking lap time.
David Pearson is currently running 11th, and going 12th is Jeff Bodine, while the 13th position is Kyle Petty. They swap him around for 14th these days. Here's Terry Labonte going back by Cale Yarborough, just squeezing down the inside, David.
And Cale Yarborough dropping in behind Terry to pick up his draft, but pulling straight out again to try and get him as he comes out to travel in front of the start-finish line here.
Here they are, dead even. And the three-time Daytona 500 winner, Yarborough, goes back in front.
And takes Bobby Allison past Terry Labonte with him.
Bobby Allison has won this 500 twice. He is the defending champion of the white and red, number 22. Now he's in second place.
Labonte slips back to fourth.
A.J. Foyt on pit road, number 14, the 1972 500 winner. The last time he won a Grand National race was 72. In Ontario, California, hope to have that Oldsmobile doing better today. Dick Hutcherson standing by as he pulls on pit road. Leaders go into three.
And Buddy Baker's pulled up to third, Blutton the Ford. Buddy Baker, always a very strong runner here at the Super Speedway.
Loves those 200-mile-an-hour laps. Baker in third. Cale Yarborough, who won the pole, who won a 125-miler. The question is, can he be the first man since 1962, when Fireball Roberts did it, to win the Triple Crown of Daytona? The pole, a 125-mile qualifying race, and go on to win the 500. It's only been done once in 25 years. Yarborough has a shot at it this year. You do not have to finish a 125-mile qualifying race if you've made the pole or the second fastest time, but most of the drivers like the money, and they really like to shake the cars down over that 125-mile distance. Hence, Yarborough coming out and just running the wheels off this car on Thursday afternoon for that 125-mile victory.
And what a race it was, and what a victory. Near the end, he just pulled out of the draft and ran away with it. It made it look very easy, which has had everybody else here pretty uneasy.
As
of course, a 500-mile race is a bit different.
As did Bobby Allison in the second 125-mile qualifier. And the other car that showed tremendous muscle was Benny Parsons. Now you're with Neil Bonnet. Here he is, closing up on Terry Labonte. You're in fifth place. You are in fifth place right now, going down the back straightaway at about 200 miles an hour. You're riding with Neil Bonnet.
As he makes a little bit of ground on Terry Labonte, see, they go into three pretty low, then the centrifugal force pushes those cars up the banking, up into that top but one lane.
Now, from Yarborough's vantage point, you're looking at second place. There's Buddy Baker, and there's the Ford, closing right up on the rear bumper. Report from the A.J. Foyt pits, Chris Economaki.
A.J. Foyt, who won this race 14 years ago, has made two pit stops. What's his trouble, Dick Hutcherson?
Chris, he says it's just like the rear wheels aren't getting a hold of the racetrack, just like being on ice out there. So we adjusted the chassis, and we're going to try that.
Is that because of the heat?
I think so. And then, Chris, we haven't had any rain this week to clean this racetrack, so the oil, the rubber on the racetrack gets a combination.
Okay, words from A.J. Foyt's pit, yet.
First to 13th, 1 8/10 seconds. Allison had the lead, reappropriated by Cale Yarborough. Baker lies third, going fourth. It's Terry Labonte, and maintaining fifth, Neil Bonnet. Back there in sixth is Harry Gant, directly behind him in seventh. Benny Parsons with eighth spot, now belonging to the man who finished fifth in a real surprise a year ago, Richard Brooks, originally out of Porterville, California.
I wouldn't say it was a surprise.
The 90 car hadn't had that good a ride here in some time. And
no, Dick Brooks really did go very well last year in his 500 mile. It looks like he's going to do the same thing this year because he's been running very consistently all through the week. And he tells me the car handles very well, as does Buddy Baker.
And for the first time this year, people have brought television sets here to the Speedway to keep track of what's going on out there. That infield is absolutely crammed today with racing enthusiasts. Largest crowd in southeastern history is here at the Daytona International Speedway. You're back with Cale Yarborough getting a gander out his rear window at Bobby Allison. Now notice they have clear glass front and aft on these cars. For some time, some of them ran that dark glass. It was outlawed because you can't see through the cars. And a lot of times, what you need to see is three or four cars in front of you.
Yes.
190-mile-an-hour drafts.
It's very confusing, and A.J. Foyt is obviously confused. He's back in pit lane again.
Here's Allison down the inside and going back into the lead. Bobby Allison sticks the Buick back in front.
Now as we...
Foyt back on pit road. Trevor Boyce out of Calgary, Alberta, Canada, number 48, runner-up for Rookie of the Year a year ago. His hopes ended, the only Canadian in the field, go up in smoke, slowing down in lap 18.
That car, of course, is run and campaigned by James Hilton, who's been around NASCAR racing almost as long as Richard Petty.
A.J. Foyt, third pit stop. Let's go to his pits.
Foyt has just had right side tires changed, and now chassis adjustments are being made by this crew, which is also his Indianapolis car crew. He's losing a lot of time here. They're adjusting both sides of the car. That's rare. Usually an adjustment is made on one side to transfer weight from the left to the right, or the right to the left, but here the mechanics have worked on both sides. AJ is trying to get the car to handle as it roars back onto the track, Ken.
Coming by. There's Trevor Boyce on pit road. Field is coming by another lap. 19 down. Yarborough stays in front. Allison stays second. Baker third. Up to fourth moves Neil Bonnet. Now there's Ken Reagan in trouble, a Unadilla, Georgia driver. Number 77, Reagan, pulling on pit road. Huh? His Chevrolet having some problems early.
That's a shame because he was going very well.
Chris has a report.
Well, we're looking at Ken Reagan again. It's a tire situation, the right front tire. The remarkable thing about racing tires is when one goes soft, the driver is never sure which one it is. And he feels that it's the right front. He may go out and he'll come back a lap later saying that wasn't it. This is because of the inner liner in the tires. And it's quite a commotion going on in this pit. Now they have a 2 minute coming back over and he's ready to head back on the racetrack, but there's a hold. Gucci was put a hold on it. They're going to change left side tires now. And he'll lose yet another lap. This is not the most well-drilled pit crew, and it's quite a commotion going on here right now. Back to you, Ken.
20 laps, 50 miles have been completed, 450 miles to go in the million-dollar Daytona 500. Back straightaway, Yarborough and Allison, they're at it again.
Well, Bobby Allison is certainly hanging in there very well, and of course, he was the car that a lot of the crew chiefs down there have been saying is going to be a major threat in this race because it's handling so well. And as we've heard already, the day's hot, the track has got slick as the week has gone on, and of course that could really play to Bobby Allison's hands as the race progresses.
Continuing to dominate, Cale Yarborough. A.J. Foyt dominated the toughest in 1972 when he led 167 of 200 laps. Kyle Petty, in his fifth Daytona 500, is in trouble. He just made a pit stop, came back on the track, a plume of smoke behind him, and the 23-year-old campaigner looks like it's going to be a short day for now. What is Petty Enterprises of Level Cross, North Carolina? Meanwhile, his father maintains 10th position in a 13-car draft as we work the 24th lap. And there is Richard Petty just in front of Ron Bouchard, who is in 11th. And just in front of him is Tim Richmond. And now there's another change of the lead. Cale Yarborough and Bobby Allison continuing to ping-pong the lead at better than 195 miles an hour.
Just going past Tommy Gale there.
How would you like to run that close to a wall at a couple hundred miles an hour?
Get like, your attention.
Just like going over the 59th Street Bridge. Turn one, go the leaders. Neil Bonnet maintaining fourth position. Terry Labonte is in the fifth spot now. tire situation developing here at Daytona. Here's another change for the lead. Down to the inside, here is Yarborough squeezing by as he works some lap traffic. Bobby Allison, Chris, what's the story on the tires?
Well, it's really not a tire story, as we found out. You know, the physical forces that act on these cars are very powerful. We've seen the crashes. Well, Ken Reagan's car developed a vibration, and that vibration broke 5 of the 9 spokes in this steel wheel, and that's why he stopped. They thought it was a tire, but it was just a vibrating that snapped these spokes right off. It's really an unbelievable situation, and down pit road, Ned Jarrett has some more information.
Chris, I'm standing by with Leonard Wood, the crew chief on Buddy Baker's car, who is currently running 7th, and what might be happening, some drivers are not, the cars aren't handling quite as well. Is it because of the heat, Leonard?
Yeah, it's got a hot, you know, and the track got slicker. And he said he was okay early in the race, but he's got some sort of vibration right now. You don't know exactly what it is.
We'll keep an eye on that in as the afternoon goes on, because heat certainly makes a difference in how the cars handle and how they need to be set up. Of course, they set them up yesterday afternoon in the last practice session. It was a pretty good temperature at that time, but racing conditions changed.
Buddy Baker is in 3rd, the Wood Brothers car, and then 10 car lengths back in 4th, Neil Bonnet. There you see the interval. Front 3, back to Bonnet and 4th.
And right in that second group is Ken Reagan, number 77, from Unadilla, Georgia, the guy that had the wheels break, and he's doing a very good job in hanging in with that lead group.
Currently in 5th is Terry Labonte. He's about to try to make a move on Neil Bonnet. And up in front, they're going at it another time. Field back in 3.
A.J. Foyt on pit road A again.
And we have a car pitting from among the leaders. It is 21. Correction. No, it is 21. It's Buddy Baker, the 1980 winner of the fastest 500-mile race in history. As you watch it live here today on CBS Sports, this special from Daytona, here's Ned Jarrett.
It is an unscheduled pit stop. Ken, they're changing the right side tires. We just heard Leonard Wood say that the car had gotten a little bit loose. Now, apparently, they got another problem under the right front. As they got that tire off, he had a little trouble getting the other one on, but they're taking a lot longer than they normally take to make a pit stop. So Buddy Baker certainly is having trouble. It looks like they're motioning him to pull behind the wall, so they got bigger problems than just tires right now.
We'll get an update on the Buddy Baker story for you in just a moment. Front 2 cars now complete the 29th lap. Allison in front, Yarborough tucked right in his rear bumper. We'll get some lap times on individual laps and a 2-car draft up in front. 3rd spot.
Well, they're lapping at about 100 to 192 miles an hour. The lap speeds have dropped quite a bit. So the track surface must be getting slippery, and the heat obviously is affecting the handling of these cars, and that has meant that Bobby Allison, a lot of people thought might be the dark horse. Although how you can call the national champion the dark horse, I'm not quite sure. But anyway, he's out there in the front right now, and he and Cale Yarborough are in fact dictating the speed of this race.
Richard Petty, coming off turn 4, is in 9th position in car number 43 as they come to the line.
Well, he's now in 7th position, right with Benny Parsons, who's also been going extremely fast this week.
Here he is closing on Parsons. That's Petty on the inside. That is for 6.
Goes underneath Benny as they go into turn 1. Petty's car is obviously handling very well because he's driving very low on the racetrack, which is unusual for him because he really likes to hug that wall.
On the other hand, the Petty cars always work well on a slippery track. That's always been the mark of the Pettys. Here he is closing up on car number 12, and he's in the inside groove, and he has Neil Bonnet. Neil Bonnet taking a look as Richard Petty just shoots underneath him there. So Richard Petty from 34th position is
now in 5th.
Up to 5th and attacking the leaders.
Who is this Moss man?
An incredible story, the Petty story,
and a great
1984.
A great Neil Bonnet eye view of him, too, there.
So Richard Petty continues to wield his magic here at Daytona. He himself has won it 7 times. The Buddy Baker story, here's Ned.
We're still by Buddy Baker's car, and Ken, they had one of the luck studs on the right front twisted off as Leonard Wood was changing that tire. Now they've had to pull it behind the wall, and you see Leonard in there working, taking the other lugs off. They'll have to replace that stud, get him back out there, killed any chance that he has of winning this Daytona 500 for the second time.
Look at this street battle between Bobby Allison in the white car on the outside and the orange and white car, Cale Yarborough. There's Yarborough tucking back into second place as they come back to the start-finish line to complete lap 32.
Over this drive under the commentary box, down, up close to that wall as they go down the short chute between the tri-oval and turn one.
Now, into third spot has moved Dale Earnhardt, and here's Richard Petty up into fourth as Terry Labonte falls back to fifth. Dale Earnhardt has been showing some muscle. He with a new number with the same colors as a year ago. Another change of the lead. Yarborough back in front. Allison to second as they swap it back and forth. Looks like a three-round amateur boxing fight out here between these two. Giving it their all in the early going on a slippery track, a warm day. We'll get a condition report as to track temperature from pit road. And we have a couple of cars. Number 71, Mike Alexander, the blue car, is pulling in, and Jody Ridley.
84, Jody Ridley. That's his second time round. He came in last lap, but unfortunately overshot the pits. He has to do another slow lap.
Working lap number 34. Lap 34, 85 miles complete, 450 to go. More live coverage of the Daytona 500 after this word from your local station. Live from the Daytona International Speedway, the Daytona 500. What a war for the lead. Right for the moment, Cale Yarborough has a little breathing room. There you see him by his lonesome. Back straight away.
Right
looking
behind
out
him is
at Dale Earnhardt. And there you see Richard Petty sneaking into your picture.
Dale Earnhardt we've rather ignored, but he has in fact been in that lead group the whole time. And he just took away second spot from Bobby Allison and took Richard Petty through with him.
Jeff Bodine has just pitted, lapping Ronnie Thomas.
Down by that wall, rushing down the wall into the tri-oval.
A.J. Foyt has officially retired. He is the fourth car out. Mike Joy will update the attrition, give you a resume if you're just joining us shortly here. And take a look at that picture from the lead car. You're looking back at Dale Earnhardt, who has never won the 500, in that second position. And there you see the line there, David. They're following so carefully and moving up out there on a slippery track.
Well, you're not seeing much two-abreast racing at the moment. That's for absolute sure.
Whoops, here comes Richard. Petty down on the inside, going for second place, tucks back in again. This at all over 190 miles per hour. And there you see Bobby Allison back of the frame working in fourth. Kyle Petty was the third retiree from the event. Here's Ned Jarrett with him.
Kyle was already changed into his street clothes. Kyle, what went wrong?
I don't know, Ned. I guess we broke a valve spring or something. The car was running real good. We were able to hang on to the draft with him, and that's really all we wanted to do. Wasn't even turning a lot of RPMs. We were just kind of riding along behind them all. I mean, you know, there was people behind me and people in front of me, so I really wasn't having to run wide open around the racetrack. So we were looking to run all day.
You and your dad raced a few laps there side by side, and then you pulled away from him.
I don't know. I got lucky right along in there. He got some people behind him messing with him, and I got lucky and caught a draft, and we went on and got separated from that pack. We were easily being able to run in the top 10 real easy, like I say, so I don't know what happened to it.
Well, it's too bad. The Kyle Petty is out of it.
About to come
Foyt
in the
is out of it also. He didn't feel like talking to
us. Cale Yarborough is pulling into the pits.
Here's Chris Economaki and Cale Yarborough's pits, the leader coming on pit road. Chris?
Rodell Wilson has got the sign. He's going to bring Cale in. It's a very cautious stop. The crew is here. We're going to put our clock on here. The wheels stop and our watch starts. It's right side tires. Fuel, those cans of fuel weigh 77 pounds, and the tires weigh 63 pounds. Now, Rodell is in there doing something. They're taking the net down. It looks pretty calm. Oh, one of the men fell down and got right up again. They're getting the second can of fuel in, and it moves 19.23 seconds. Pit men are faced with a lot of extra work this year. Again, those fuel cans weigh 77 pounds, the tires weigh 63 pounds, and the new pit wall is this much higher, this much thicker, that much more. They have to move the material over, and it's not easy with that kind of weight. During the week, several pit men stumbled over the wall being used to the lower height. Back to you, Ken.
The new leader in the Daytona 500 is pit stop. So now the order of the day, it's number 43, Richard Petty, from 34th place, the seven-time winner of this event. About to put a lap on Mike Alexander in the back straightaway, and he's moving up on Bouchard. Now, Bouchard, I believe, has already made his pit stop all along pit road. Tim Richmond is in. Carroll Waltrip, Richard Brooks is pulled on pit road. Bill Elliott in a fueling situation. Harry Gant is in. Let's see if Petty will pit now. Petty is in front, and he is going to pit, and Bobby Allison is going to pit as well. So first and second place are coming in. This should move. Car number 98, Joe Ruttman, up into the lead. Ruttman is pitting. He was the third place car the way the race was scattered.
Buddy Bank is pulled behind the wall. Buddy.
Here's Chris Economaki.
Okay, where Richard Petty's been, he's being serviced now. This man has come from way in the back to lead this race. He's doing a remarkable job, a truly remarkable job. Now they're creating dust and debris from under the front bumper. That tells us that the track is dirty, and they're taking the number off the front there to want to get more air in. So the heat is, here in the pitch, Ken.
Now you notice that's an all-new team that's been organized in just 2 weeks, and there was a little problem as he came back on the track. The man just on the front who was working trying to clean that car nearly got himself underneath it, and they dragged him away. You can see some concern down there. They just haven't had that much time to work together on the Petty team. Pit stops have taken place unofficially now. Cale Yarborough has gone back into the first position in car number 28, and we're waiting for official scoring here as we have a pit stop under green. The speed has climbed up to 158 mile an hour average. Now remember, the speed record is 177 miles an hour, 1980, Buddy Baker. Baker lost several laps while they worked on the car. And there is a problem on Richard Petty's car. Here's the story.
You guys did a lot of work on Richard's car there besides change tires and fuel. What is the story?
Wait a minute, I can't copy you.
What? I okay. Say you did a lot of work besides change tires and add fuel on Richard's car. What were you doing?
Well, we just gave Richard a good cold drink of Gatorade and got him going back out there. There's no problem. The car, we just cleaned the screen real good, and that's all.
Okay, Buddy Pratt, confident and happy. Richard Petty, remember now, he came from way back to lead. Ken?
As the field meanders down out of the turn, the problem was he needed a drink, David. That was
I don't blame him. It was pretty warm like this. Now, Dale Earnhardt did a very quick pit stop on that round of pit stops in just over 13 seconds, 13.7. It's about the quickest of the leaders. And we'll have to wait and see where the field shuffles down to.
Now, as things shake out, remember that Neil Bonnett had been in. They are now showing Neil Bonnett, number 12, as the lead car. Neil Bonnett, with the number 12, is being shown as the leader. So after this period of pit stops, and we're getting well into the race, let's join Mike Joy and get an update, resume, on what has happened thus far. Here's Mike.
Engine failure is not uncommon here, Ken. Already the first three cars out of the race suffered engine failures. Ironic that Dave Marcus should be the first. He's NASCAR's hard luck driver, runs around with a cloud over his head. A.J. Foyt, three pit stops to try to cure a suspension problem. They couldn't. He's gone back to the garage. Buddy Baker's car is behind the pit wall. They're replacing the wheel studs, as you saw earlier. They're going to try to get Baker back in the race. Ken?
All right, after the pit stops have been completed, we are now working the 44th lap, and here is how they stand. The leader, well out in front after that incredible pit stop he made, is car number 3. Dale Earnhardt in the Bud Moore car is currently shown first. Bobby Allison is second. Richard Petty is third. Terry Labonte is fourth. And this car, number 28, is in the fifth position. Those are the front five, as they've just been given by scoring. So it's number 3, your leader, just coming to the start-finish line. Richard Petty hovering right there, trying to get himself his 8th Daytona 500 victory with a brand new team. More from Daytona in a moment. Working the 47th lap, 153 remaining in our live coverage of the million-dollar Great American Race, the Daytona 500, with a new leader. Bobby Allison, there you see him, is back in front. And right behind him comes Dale Earnhardt. There's Allison in first. Lake Speed now pitting car number 1, the Haas Ellington machine. Back on on the racetrack as Lake Speed has trouble. You see Richard Petty in the third position. Running fourth overall is Terry Labonte. Running in fifth is Kaley Ocaro. And in the sixth position at the present time is Richard Brooks in the Juni Donlevy car. Cars out of four. And here's Kaley Ocaro fighting for fourth position with Terry Labonte. Right behind Yarborough now, Tim Richmond is on the move. Here's Yarborough closing again on the fourth place car. Terry Labonte on the high side. Kaley Ocaro passes him. And you can swap the positions. It's Yarborough now fourth, and here comes Tim Richmond. Number 27, Richmond, gathers up his car. He told me last night he was very skitterish about this race today. Now you see 90, the white car on the inside, also trying to get through. Petty makes a move. Richard Petty in the second spot. Allison first. And number 43, Richard Petty, goes to second. Earnhardt falling to third.
We fell into the trap of discounting Richard Petty about 5 years ago when we did this race, I believe. But that is a magnificent pull-up in just a few laps.
It's the perfect kind of day for 46-year-old Richard Petty. He likes it when it's warm. So, for that matter, does Allison. They thrive on a hot weather race. The track temperature now reported about 95, 98 degrees. And inside those cockpits, roasting time.
Well, of course, the skill of the older generation will show, I'm afraid. These young lads have a long way to go. Look at the list of last year's champions.
Petty for the lead. Richard Petty scoops down the inside. And Richard Petty from 34th spot for the second time today has taken the lead in the 1984 Daytona 500. Always the story of Daytona since his father won it in that dead heat finish in 1959. But this year is a sad story, the Petty story. For the Petty dynasty as we have known it changes dramatically as of this 26th annual Daytona 500. With his fans, with most of the folks here, he is still the king with 198 wins. But it's a different team. Earnhardt lies third, Kaley Ocaro fourth, and Richmond, Tim Richmond, is now fifth. Now there's Kale. And let's take a look at fifth, sixth, and seventh now. There you see them coming up through the field. Terry Labonte there. On the inside, that looks like Dick Trickle to me. Great Midwestern star who's been having a fine weekend. Greg Sachs, modified driver out of the state of New York, sticks his nose right in there. Back for the leaders. Petty, front of that car, number 17. New driver, Clark Dwyer. Roger Hamby machine that Sterling Marlin drove a year ago. Latest rundown shows eighth spot, Bill Elliott in the ninth spot, Harry Gant in 10th is Bouchard. Rusty Wallace is pitting car number 88. The Cliff Stewart number 88 has just pulled on pit road. 11th is Benny Parsons. 12th, Waltrip. 13th, Bonnet. There you see Wallace. And going 14th now is David Pearson with 15th, Ricky Rudd.
Well, the no-neck monster from Timmonsville, South Carolina, is winding in the lead. He's gradually picking up with no draft to help him. He's running on his own, and he's gradually picking up that leading trio.
Let's check the interval between the front three and this man, Kaley Ocaro, number 28, seeking to win his fourth 500 today.
We're ahead of you, Kenley. We've done it. My man Greg in the corner has already done it.
Now you see the interval as they go down the back straightaway in back of Lake Lloyd. Front three, back to the fourth place car, right here, 28, Kaley Ocaro. They're the leaders up in turn four. The interval was 5 4/10 seconds. It's an even 5 seconds. Now it's down to 4.7 in the last four laps. Let's go to Ned Jarrett.
We're standing by with Richard Childers, a former driver himself, now the owner of the car. Dale Earnhardt is running in third place. Richard, you had that first pit stop. You looked at the tires. How are they wearing? Is there any indication that the track is slicker than usual?
Everything looks about like we anticipated. We just need to change our left side now to get our stagger and all back right. Car's just a little loose getting in. Other than that, everything's okay.
Dale seems to be content riding along there behind Petty and Allison. Is that part of the plan?
Yeah, the car feels a little better right there right now getting in behind them.
That's the story from the Dale Earnhardt pit.
Coming around. trying to complete 54 laps. Here's a report
from
Chris.
When I was 12 years old, I took a 60-mile trip to a race, and the one thing I really wanted was a pit pass. But this little guy is from Willimantic, Connecticut. How old are you? What's your name? Billy, who's your favorite driver? He's got a big Bobby Allison thing. That's the story here at Daytona. Up and down this pit fence, fans from all ages and from all over. I wish they could get in the pit pass and kick the tires and get a close look at the cars and drivers. Back to you, Ken.
Well, his guy is now running third. Dick Trickle, at number 42, has just pulled on pit road. Midwestern champion Trickle is now on pit road. Meanwhile, the leader remains Richard Petty. There's Dick Trickle, at number 42. Seeking a little sponsorship there. That whole lid is empty on that car. Unusual, David.
Well, I expect you'll be sending him a check very shortly, Kenley, as a well-known
as a
activist from 4 seconds. Caleb is now behind third-place car. So Caleb is gradually catching up. He's pulling away from Tim Richmond, who's also running in a completely draft-free zone. And Richard Brooks is hanging on there.
55 laps are down in the 1984 Daytona 500. 137 and a half miles have been completed. More in a moment. There you see the standings at 58 laps. 145 miles. Dick Trickle saying goodbye to this race. He is the eighth retiree from the Daytona 500. Live here on CBS, you're watching Richard Petty. One of the most outstanding performances as he goes for win number 199. Reaching closer and closer to that magic mark no one in the sport has attained in Major League Racing of 200 wins. Guys like Trickle, even Bobby Allison, they have done it on all the short track series, but in a Major League series, Petty at 198. David Pearson second in the all-time win list at 105.
It seems to be hardly credible, but as you can see from that picture there, Richard Petty is stretching his lead on Dale Earnhardt and Bobby Allison on his own. He's just starting to drive away from those two cars following him. Now, Cale Yarborough is definitely catching up with the third car in the train. Having run for such a long time on his own, he'll be using fuel at a faster rate than the guys who are drafting, which may upset his pit stop routine.
He's about to overlap Ricky Wright as they go down into turn number one. There's Petty on the outside. That two-car draft just up in front harbors that car that had the terrible crash here just last Sunday with Ricky Wright. Went end over end and side over side out of turn number four. There you see the second place car. There is Dale Earnhardt at number three. And Petty is pulled away from that Ford with his Pontiac. There you see the Pontiac in first. The Ford is now in second.
Bobby Allison is slowing down in turn three. Bobby Allison slowing down. It can't be a regular pit stop time.
Something amiss. Allison has dropped to the inside of turn four. There you see him, bottom of the track. Yarborough whips by him. And the two-time winner of this event, Bobby Allison, coming down on the pit road. Here's Ned Jarrett.
Well, Bobby Allison has coasted into the pit stand. It doesn't seem as if he has power. You're right. It is an unscheduled pit stop. The hood goes up. They're working to see if it is ignition or something that they can repair very quickly. But the former two-time winner of this Daytona 500 running so well here today, and certainly one of the pick among the crews in the garage area after his performance here on Thursday, is in trouble here at Daytona right now. We'll try to find out exactly what is wrong and get back to you in a moment, Ken.
That moves Cale Yarborough into third, Terry Labonte up to fourth, Richard Brooks goes to fifth, up to sixth moves Joe Ruttman, in seventh is Gant, eighth Bill Elliott, and ninth is Ron Bouchard, with tenth now Benny Parsons. Bobby Allison in trouble on pit road, has been coming here since 1961. There you see Rusty Wallace's number 88 being lapped by Richard Petty on the long back straightaway, and the point that David Hobbs made a few.
Oh, and another car erupts on the back straightaway. It's blown an engine right on the straight.
Slowing down, going into the corner is Bobby Hillen. Bobby Hillen. Hillen's in trouble. The Midland, Texas driver, 19 years old.
Caution is out.
So there's going to be a wholesale pit flurry here, because we're about due for pit stops anyway, for the next 10 laps or so.
We were talking to Ronnie last night. His mother had flown in from Midland, Texas, to see him in his first Super Speedway race. He almost had it going last year. And on the last lap of the 125-mile qualifier, it just didn't work out for him. So we are under caution for only the second time today. It happens in the 63rd lap. The story of Daytona is this man, Richard Petty. The story in 1984 is a far different story than we have ever told before of King Richard. Here is the 1984 story of the Petty dynasty.
The Petty racing dynasty that originated in Level Cross, North Carolina, was never a team. It was a family. Now America's first family of racing is breaking up. Richard Petty is moving some 60 miles from the homestead where his father Lee built the first Petty car in 1948. Through the years, Richard lived next to his dad, his brother Maurice across the road, and all within hailing distance of the shops that have produced 9 championships and 261 wins. As the breakup takes place, the clan patriarch, Lee Petty, hones his golf game on the front lawn and deals with the question, why?
Time. It's no way that things today like it was yesterday. And it's no way tomorrow it'll be like it is today. A lot of that changes gradually. You don't see it, but it's a gradual change. And then something like this comes along, and then that just completes the cycle. I mean, it's no way out.
But what evoked this change that in 36 years has generated over $6 million in purse alone? Why, at 46, is King Richard abdicating this cherished part of his domain?
The future is Kyle Petty. Just as if Richard Petty took over from Lee Petty, it's time for Kyle Petty to start in that vein to take over from Richard Petty.
Richard's 23-year-old son, Kyle, continues his career in the Petty shops where it began for him when he was 18. Richard shocked the racing community when he chose as his son's first ever practice field the Daytona Speedway. Kyle responded by winning his very first race, a 200-mile preliminary to the Daytona 500. Since then, Kyle's results have been mediocre at best, with no wins. He now inherits the place his father vacates as the family gambles on the future.
As it turned out, it helped him, we feel like, and to let him get out in the last 5 or 6 years or 50 years that he races, however long he's going to race, to let him get out on his own and do some stuff away from the family that he's been into. It gave us a chance for me to really separate on my own almost, and I think it was a big deal, big step for him to go out, but we felt like that Petty Enterprise used to win races in the 60s, early 70s, and when I started racing, it kind of drug the team down to a two-car team, and that's the only way you can look at it. It was a stumbling block for Richard Petty, and we feel like that with him gone, then or me gone, whichever one left, that it picked up both teams again.
From their home, Linda Petty speaks of 1984 as the year of decision for her son, Kyle.
I would say Kyle's going to come out the worst on this thing because he's got a long way to go and a lot to learn. At the end of the year, if things don't go well, Kyle can't say, well, Uncle Morris, it's your fault, or Daddy, it's your fault. It can't be anybody's fault but Kyle's, because Kyle's running the show.
There is more to this than making room for Kyle. This man, Dale Inman, Richard's crew chief, cousin, friend, left Petty Enterprises after their 1981 Daytona 500 win. It is said that Inman and Maurice Petty weren't communicating. The breakup had begun, and it was hard on all concerned.
When you say sacrifice, what do you mean?
Sometimes you have to put your family aside, seems like, to get the car ready.
But the single incident, which seems to have changed the old Petty ties, came last October in the Charlotte 500. Richard handily passed Darrell Waltrip in recording his 198th win. The post-race NASCAR inspection found Petty's engine was illegal, oversized. Maurice Petty was in charge of engine construction, and Richard had not been told that he was winning the hand with a stacked deck. Fined $35,000, change was now imminent. Maurice Petty still lives just across the road, still an officer in Petty Enterprises. But he is out of the fabricating shops, out of the engine room. That's part of another lifetime.
Somebody's gonna hurt someone.
He now manages a country rock band, Slewfoot, that thunders through the Carolina nights, and daily he ponders the changes.
I don't think it'll ever be the same again because, like I say, with Kyle coming in, that's a whole new generation. Me and Richard, we got along together. We had our differences and we had our problems. But with two of us, we could always work it out. And then you start throwing two and three and four and five people in there, then, you know, it's hard to work out. And instead of having our differences, I just stepped aside and see what happened.
The biggest decision that I feel like that I've made was saying, okay, we're going to change the whole concept of Petty Enterprises. Richard Petty's leaving, Kyle Petty's staying, Maurice Petty is no longer building engines. The whole deal has changed so much in, say, the last 3 months that it's going to be a completely different world that I'm going out in this year than what I did last year or for the last 25 years.
The outcome of these changes is a matter for the record book. The constant remains the man, Richard Petty.
Things are going to happen with or without you. The sun's going to come up tomorrow. It's going to go down. The world's going to turn whether I'm there or whether I'm not. So you are not going to stop the world. The world does not revolve around Richard Petty. Richard Petty revolves in the world. So the situation is that if something happens to me, I'm not going to stop either. The only time I stop is when they close the door on top of that little casket the last time, and that's it. Any other time, you can come back and do it.
They have just taken green. We are back underway. It is the 67th lap, and Richard Petty is coming back. He is in second place. Dale Earnhardt is leading. There you see them. They have just taken the green a half lap ago. We have experienced the fourth caution today. And there is Cale Yarborough directly behind Petty in third. A battle of the masters. Tim Richmond has been on pit road for several laps. Now you are seeing Earnhardt fall back. You are watching Richard Petty take command. Here is Tim Richmond trying to fire number 27 and come back into the Daytona 500. Meanwhile, among the leaders, Petty is first. Yarborough is second. Earnhardt is third.
Nick Brooks and Joe Rutler in fourth and fifth with Bill Elliott in sixth. And it looks like that front group have made a break. This is a break, of course, for Bill Elliott and, of course, Nick Brooks to be able to get back right with those leaders again and try and hang on to that lead drop.
The fourth position, Richard Brooks, number 90 in a Ford, and then comes number 98, Joe Rutman. On the back straightaway, a pass for the lead, down to the inside. Yarborough goes back in front. Car number 43, Petty, falls to second. Earnhardt tries to move up. Earnhardt comes to the inside. He's trying to find a way to move through. Right behind him is the fourth place car, Richard Brooks, and then comes Joe Rutman. In the caution period, another major retiree from the race. Ninth retiree. One of the favorites to win it. He's standing by on pit road, Tommy Allison.
Grand National Champion, two-time winner of this race, but out of it today. Why, Bobby?
Something went wrong in the motor. Running real good and handling good, and all of a sudden it just shut off, indicated that the camshaft broke, but we're not sure yet.
Bobby, some have said that the track is a little different from maybe the way they anticipated it. It's hotter here today than normal. Is it a little slick, and your car, though, seemed to be adapting to that?
Well, the track is slick. That's what happens when it gets warm, and we were hooked up pretty good to it. I was very pleased with my car. About the only one that really impressed me, it looks like Robert Yates built Petty an awful good engine for today too, and he was handling pretty good too. He was strong. Looked like the only other one that I thought really was hooked up and running strong.
Of course, Robert Yates, who builds the engines for DieGuard, Bobby Allison's crew, does build the engines now for Richard Petty, and so Bobby Allison likes to look to him right now.
95 mile an hour freight train down the back straightaway. On the tail end of it, a ninth spot is Bill Elliott. He's one to really look for today. Elliott won the final race of 1983 at Riverside, California, to decide the Winston Cup in favor of Bobby Allison as the champion last year. Now there's Neil Bonnet. Now he's running further back. Bonnet currently, latest rundown, had him in 12th. Now you're back with Cale Yarborough.
And Cale has clear sailing. And here's Neil Bonnet. Ricky Rudd directly in front of Neil Bonnet. Get well, Doug. Doug Richard, his crew chief, run over, hit on pit row, broken leg yesterday in the running of the 300-mile sportsman race. Watching today from the hospital. More from the 1984 Daytona 500 live in a moment. Under caution for the third time today after 49-year-old Tommy Gale from Pennsylvania had a motor come unglued just past the start-finish line. It looked like it ate something that didn't agree with it, and it streaked the track with a little oil coming down through the tri-oval.
To the motor, as you would say.
Best finish he's had here was the 11th back in 72. He's been running in the 500 since 1970. The Elmo Langley car, number 64, the Sonny King entry, having trouble. Terry Labonte is on pit road. He's running 12th overall in the race. Doug Heverin there in the yellow and red car also pulling on pit road. Heverin is an interesting story. We'll get to in a bit, we would hope. Modified champion from up around Oswego where the Supers run. There's Doug Heverin's car.
Well, how
there you see the
that?
Field. And goodbye for Tommy Gale. Back to the garage area early for him. This happening, he goes back in the 74th lap. He blew in lap 73. 11th retiree from the day. Tim Richmond has also officially retired from this afternoon's 26th annual Daytona 500, which you are watching live here on CBS Sports today. Delighted to have you with us. The largest crowd, we believe, in the Daytona history. Largest crowd in the Southeast has congregated for this day. Ned Jarrett is standing by with Tim Richmond in the garage area. Let's see if we can get a word.
Well, as you can see, Tim is out of his car and out of the race. Why, Tim?
Out of my mind, too, I guess. I don't know. The cylinder head on the engine cracked from the outside. It didn't crack on the inside more. It cracked on the outside. Started spewing water out onto the spark plugs, which fouled them all out, and which it can't run like that. So supposedly NASCAR is going to have a test of cylinder heads this coming Tuesday. In other words, in 2 days, but that's a little late for today.
That's an unusual occurrence for it to crack from the outside.
Well, it's not an unusual occurrence for these heads. We complained about them all last year, and now, you know, it's again here this year. And it is unusual for it to crack from the outside, but that's just to show how defective they really are, that we can't get the good stuff. And hopefully Tuesday will prove out that the test, we can get the good stuff and won't have this kind of problem. It's not good for the fans when their cars are sitting in the garage.
Tim, it's a hotter day here at Daytona than normal for the Daytona 500. Well, how was it affecting you? How was it out there, and how has it affected the track?
As far as physically, it was fine on myself. The racetrack is, it's not the best I've ever seen it, but it's not terrible. It's not bad. It's not bad at all, but it could be better. I could still be out there.
That would make it a lot better for him, Ken.
75 laps complete, 125 to go, 312 miles left. We'll be back with more live coverage of the Daytona 500. Back with you once again, live at Daytona Beach, Florida. And there you are watching the pictures from Cale Yarborough's number 28, following the pace car, the safety car, through the 31-degree banking. Cale Yarborough now running first. Richard Petty is in second. Dale Earnhardt is third. Cale Yarborough, this is Ken Squire at CBS Control. That car looks like it's doing just about anything you want it to do today, Cale.
Well, the car is handling pretty good, Ken. The racetrack is awful greasy. It's awful slick, and I'm having to let the car run up the racetrack more than I like for it to, but nothing I can do about it.
Cale, it's David here. Is Richard Petty a surprise to you, coming back from 34th position like that and giving you a hard run now?
Yeah, looks like Richard Petty might be the man to beat today. He's really running strong, and he's going to be tough today.
How's his engine compared to yours, you feel?
It looks like we put it pretty equal on power, and Rich's car is working good, too. If he runs all day and I run all day, it should be a good race.
Just how greasy is that track now, Cale?
Ken, it's about as greasy as I've ever seen it in February. Of course, it's awful hot today, and I think that's what's causing the racetrack to be slick.
Well, we have another lap coming up under caution before we run away. Thank you very much, Cale Yarborough. We're talking with a man that's on the point, and we'll be back in a moment from the World Center of Speed, Daytona Beach, Florida.
The
Sports Special is sponsored by...
...has come back on the track, as has David Pearson. David Pearson just out of the pits now. The pit, such a key part of this game. Here is Chris Economaki for a quick report.
I'm down in Richard Petty's pit. Curve, STP crew, is really something. Lake Speed, who was pitted next door, is out of the race. In the last 5 minutes, crew chief Buddy Parrott has sent men out onto the track. They've remarked, that's Richard Petty's old stopping point. This is his new stopping point down here. They've picked up the equipment, they've moved over, and they've taken half of the Lake Speed pit to get some more elbow room so there's no crowding. The last time in, Richard Petty's men took this little aluminum plate off the left front headlights. They wouldn't say why, but the oil cooler is right behind this. They want to get a little bit more air there. It's really a slick crew doing a great job.
Yeah. In Sylvia Wilkinson's book, Dirt Tracks to Glory, she quotes Ralph Moody as saying, the driver isn't out there by himself. If the guy in the pits is any good at running the team, he also runs the race car out of the pits. So be it with car number 43 at this point. Here we are getting ready for the green flag to fall. It is 78 laps complete when they come down this time. 195 miles down, 305 miles to go. In the 1984 million-dollar Great American Race, bunched up with Cale Yarborough first, Richard Petty trying to win it again, win number 199 in his career. Can he do it? In third spot, Earnhardt. Fourth, Richard Brooks. Fifth, Joe Rutman. Sixth, Bill Elliott, as they trundle down into turn number one.
Building up speed as they go through turn two there, coming down to that back straight. Up to our speed shot, halfway down the straight.
Rutman to the inside, making a move. Joe Rutman is moving around the Jeff Bodine car, a lap down.
Bill Elliott is right with Joe Rutman, and so also is Harry Camp, who is on the same lap.
Darrell Waltrip is back there in ninth position. Eighth position is Bouchard. Tenth position is Parsons. Neil Bonnet's in 12th. There you see them in front of this tremendous congregation here at the Daytona Speedway. And you are looking out of the front-running car at the figure that is shadowing him, Richard Petty. Pulls right up on the rear bumper, running just about 3 inches or less apart at over 190 miles per hour. Well, they're further apart than that, as this picture now shows.
He's dropped back a bit there. He's probably 3 feet behind now.
Oh, like maybe 10. Close enough.
There you can see the cars weaving and dancing around over those bumps. You can also see Richard Petty's hood flapping there in the wind off Cale's car. The closer he gets, the more it flaps.
Well, the wind is coming off that lead car and just socking down onto that hood and onto the windshield. Gives you an idea of why, when they're running these tremendous speeds, they crack those windshields.
You could also see on that shot why they banned those dark screens, because you can see quite clearly through Richard's car, you can see Dale Earnhardt right behind him, and that, of course, is what they wanted the driver to be able to see through the two cars in front of them.
There's Waltrip and Elliott, and right behind him, Bouchard. And there's Harry Gant in the picture, in the Bandit, number 33. Bill Elliott,
coming
sixth position.
That.
There is Rutman in the fifth, just in front of him. Two groups of cars in this front-running squadron. 81 complete. Still Yarborough up there. Now you're inside the car of Neil Bonnet. Directly in front of him is the lap car of Jeff Bodine.
Going down that back straightaway, you see his rev counter there, hovering around about 7,200 RPM. There it is. What is it coming up to?
Appears to be...
Just drops
position.
Up a little bit there. You see it drops down almost dead on 7,000 as he's going through the turn. And it'll gradually pick up here in the draft, as it there you see it going up to about 7,400. Quite enough for that big old Chev.
Neil Bonnet running 12th. You're inside of his car. He's up to 11. And there he is, flat-footed down through there.
Well, you can see him just lifting a little tiny bit. Of course, it depends on the draft in the car in front, but he's there, a little tiny lift there.
And it's just those little tiny nuances with the feet that make the difference on a super speedway when you're working the draft as these men are right now.
The reason that most of that speed is lost on the banking axle is not because they lift off and slow down. It's just a pure rolling resistance as the car turns into the turn. It just scrubs speed off.
The Jeff Bodine number 5 car is running 13th. He is one lap down. Currently in 14th is David Pearson. In the 15th position is Phil Parsons. In the 16th position is Greg Sachs. And in 17th is Ricky Rudd.
Jeff Bodine right up there with the leaders. We could come to one of those situations where if we have another caution, Bodine could lead the group across the line. He would in fact get his lap back.
Earlier we asked Cale Yarborough, where we see you on race cam, is it as bumpy as it looks?
The race cars, you know, these race cars are awful stiff, and of course the racetrack is, there's no way to have a smooth racetrack, and when you hit one of these bumps on the racetrack, it does bounce you around quite a bit. So what you see on the camera is what's happening in the race car.
Arms working like pistons as he fights that car down into turns 1 and 2. Cale Yarborough, you're in the lead automobile. Blue sky and clear roads in front of him as he heads into the back straightaway.
And you can see what sort of lock he has to put on to get that big machine through those really relatively sharp corners.
Here's Richard Petty closing at turn 3. Two of the all-time masters of super speedway racing in our live pictures from the Daytona International Speedway. The 26th annual $1 million 500 is just one of the dandiest races they've ever had here thus far. Now remember, we are 84 laps deep, 210 miles, 290 to go. But look at that choo-choo train up in front.
Ron Bouchard and Phil Elliott getting side by side as they came off the tri-oval then, right up to the wall, Ron Bouchard.
Let's take a look at the battle now for 7th, 8th, and 9th. There's Bouchard in the 47. Working their way up the backside. That looks like Bonnet trying to break out.
Is that narrow wall chip or Bonnet?
That's Bonnet. And right behind him comes Benny Phil Parsons in the 55.
Benny Parsons.
And there is Ron Bouchard right in front of Neil Bonnet. You can see all the way to the lead. There's about 11 cars running within 1 second of each other at 190 miles per hour.
There's the two teammates. Number 11 and 12, Darrell Walton and Neil Bonnet running close together. The first time they've been together in the whole weekend.
Bonnet pulling up on Bouchard. Say goodnight to Ron Bouchard here. Bouchard, who won at Talladega, as you'll recall, in 1981 in that dramatic finish on CBS. Now, another move. Walton falling back. And Bonnet's beginning to show some life out there. Back with the leaders again. Here comes Petty on the inside. Richard Petty down low. Yarborough in the 28 car high. Cars collected in that lead draft. A couple of them are lapped down, maybe three. They're running at the present time. Three, first to 16th, they're reporting, even outside the draft. 3 1/10 of a second apart. To the tri-oval, the 17-degree banking, headed for the 31-degree bank at turn 1. It turns you up on your side like you're running on a barrel here. And notice how high they're running the track here, David.
They've started to move up. The racing line always tends to go higher as the race progresses. And we're seeing that now. Richard, of course, does like to run high anyway.
But what you may see if that line works up at this early juncture of the race is Petty, late in the race, will dive and use the inside. It's one of the ways he collected all those wins. He always had something going in the suspension department on a slippery racetrack. And once that inside groove would dry out just a hair, he'd go down there and find a place to run where others could not. Inside Yarborough's car.
There you can see how that windscreen now is starting to get not only dirty, but a lot of those marks are permanent. There's the shells and the dust, the grit. It starts to chip the screen, and however much they clean it, that stuff won't come off. There you see him, right behind Dale Earnhardt.
now as we go down the back straight coming into turn three.
Now remember, Earnhardt is with a new team this year, and he's trying to push that Ford out in front. He wobbled for just a second going to three. Petty pulls away. There are the front four. That fourth place car, Richard Brooks, he was fifth here a year ago in a junior Dunlevy effort. But Dale Earnhardt, he takes over the Bud, who takes over the Tim Brewer ride. He had the Bud Moore ride a year ago. Now finds himself in second spot.
Richard Brooks is hanging on very well in that Ford. He's very competitive with his lead group, and he's hanging right in there.
I'd say Ford Chevrolet is correct on that car, number three. The Chevrolet's one and two. The Ford is the Bud Moore car. Here's the blimp, giving us a picture of a lead change going into the east end of the Speedway.
An attempted lead change. Dale Earnhardt dropped down out of Richard's draft, tried to make a run at him going through three, and it didn't quite come off.
Richard Petty drives away. Here comes Cale Yarborough taking a flat shot at second spot. More in a moment. An elation for Petty in the last half hour turned to sadness, tragedy. Car number 53 has just lost its engine while in the lead of the Daytona 500. Petty is dropped on the bottom side of the racetrack, and he is headed for the garage area, and he is out of the 26th Daytona 500. Cale Yarborough there is now once again the leader, with Dale Earnhardt in second, and Richard Brooks is in third. Petty limping slowly onto pit road.
Well, it left a little trail of smoke going through turns one and two there, not much, but obviously enough, because whatever has happened, it's brought him to a complete halt. He'll probably turn into the garage.
Win 199 will not be today.
Behind the wall.
It happened in the first and second turn. Just a little smidgen of smoke out of the back of the car, and then lost power. He eased it up against the outside wall, and this herd thundered through.
Cale Yarborough asserting what, by NASCAR standard, is a massive lead. And probably an 8-1-9 Carling, and drawing away from the pursuing pack. North Carolina visiting the pit there under green, losing valuable time, but he's away with one tire change.
Richard Petty is the 12th retiree from the 42 car starting field. Working lap number 94. 106 laps remaining.
Richard Brooks getting very loose as he tried to go round. There you see him alongside Dale Earnhardt. And behind them now is Terry Labonte, who was on the front row, the only other man to do 200 miles an hour here this week. Richard Brooks looking just a bit squirrely as they came off the tri-oval, trying to get down the inside of Dale Earnhardt, who we are now looking at out of Cale Yarborough's leading car. There come the next two. Brooks being helped here by Dale Earnhardt, which drags them both by Dale Earnhardt. Terry Labonte, I mean. Terry Labonte, car number 44, the third car there in the line, came out, helped Richard Brooks get by Dale.
Back to the line. 96 laps complete. And it is Richard Brooks in second, Earnhardt in third. Terry Labonte lies fourth. Now there's Labonte. Getting ready to look at the inside. Here is Ned Jarrett with Richard Petty.
He had just climbed out of his famous number 43. Richard, it looked awfully good for a while.
Yeah, it was for a while. The only thing about it is we're sitting here and we're not running, but everything worked perfect. You know, the car ran good, handled good, and not only we had them all covered or not, but we could race with them. That was the main thing.
Ken Squire made mention of the fact that it seems like on slick racetracks, and this track is slicker than normal for the Daytona 500 because it's hotter here than usual, that you always seem to prevail on that kind of a racetrack.
Well, I don't know. The longer we run, the better we would have been. If I put it that way. Try getting slicker and slicker, and those boys are getting where they can't run wide open in the corner. I can run my car wide open, and you know, that was going to be the difference when it really come down to the end of it.
You know, Ken, it's amazing that the man is always able to smile even after a disaster of this sort. Now let's go up on pit road with Chris Economaca, who is with Waddell Wilson, the crew chief on Cale Yarborough's car.
Well, now that the pressure is off, that Petty was the only guy that could run with you, and you going to handle things any differently?
Well, you know, everything's going well for us. I'm worrying about our car now for the simple fact that Bobby's running up front. He fell out. Richard was up there, and he's out. And we've been up there as much as anyone. You know, the heat today is hard on the cars, the engine, the running gear, and the tires, because, you know, whenever it's hot, the tires, you know, get crazy and begin to slide around. And we're having a problem with that right now. The tire is not sticking like it should.
Okay, back to you, Ken. Rusty Wallace in trouble. Caution is on the track. Rusty Wallace is number 88. The Cliff Stewart car has spun. This will bring out caution number four. Caution number four is now coming on the track. You wonder if there is an upset in the making here today. Let's have a replay of what happened with the Cliff Stewart car. Petty is out. Allison is out. And you begin to see some new faces up on that leaderboard. There's Rusty Wallace in a whole lot of trouble.
He did a reverse spin and...
Ronnie Thomas in the 41.
Ronnie Thomas's heart now must be just about stationary.
He had the right saint on that one.
He missed him by a thousandth.
Ronnie Thomas is on his third engine. He went out and bought a $14,000 engine from Richard Petty the other day, and it's the last nickel, and he said it was his banker's last nickel.
Here we have a mass in road onto pit road. Cal Yarborough, we see him coming up to his pit crew now. They were about ready for stuff.
Here's Chris.
Okay, Cale Yarborough is in. It's a very calm crew here, unruffled. They're doing things very quickly, but they do it in an unhurried manner. The radiator's cleaned off, the windshield, right side tires, things are getting checked. Cale is talking to one of his microphones, the other one is ours. The second can of fuel is in. Now they're loosening the lug nuts on the left side. It will be a four-tire change. Remember what Waddell Wilson said, that the tires are getting hot and greasy. Now these tires are not worn out. They're just hot. They'll maybe go back on the car at another pit stop. There's the pneumatic wrenches. You can see how fast the men work. In a position, and away he goes. Oops, doesn't have to go reverse because the small man has blocked his way. Work to save a split second and a car in his way, and that split second and then some more. Back to you, Ken.
Dale Earnhardt, first man out. Dale Earnhardt puts number three back on the track.
Well, Dale Earnhardt's crew have been working extremely well today. He's made some very, very good pit stops.
Richard Childress' crew getting Earnhardt in and out in the traditional way. Remember, Bud Moore wore those colors for a while, and back in the days, the white and blue number 15, Moore always made good pit stops. Now that Earnhardt, must be something's rubbed off over there, because this crew is doing an outstanding job. There's Rusty Wallace coming in with the number 88. The Chevrolet badly thrashed. We'll be back with more as we come to the halfway point of the Daytona 500 in a moment. We are under caution at the halfway mark in the 1984 Daytona 500. Let's get a sports update. Standing by in New York, here's Jim Kelly. One of the cars that just had trouble here, number 88, Rusty Wallace, St. Louis driver, being pushed back to the garage area here. He had trouble up in the banking. Let's look again at exactly what happened to Rusty Wallace. David Hobbs?
Well, it looks like he just lost control there, went up, T-boned the outside wall, did the classic, came down, and young Ronnie Thomas was unbelievably lucky to avoid him, and it didn't seem to faze him. He never even swerved, but it put Rusty Wallace out of the race.
That's the one thing you don't want to do, is swerve, because if you go where you think they're not, that's
where
they'll
be
when you get there.
That's exactly right. Plus, you'd probably hit the wall yourself anyway.
Now, the circumstance is this, as we watch Doug Heverin's car coming back on the track, the number 01, in his first Super Speedway start today. Oswego, New York champion back on the track. The standings, interesting here. All of a sudden, Darrell Waltrip is up into the second position. Richard Brooks is in third. Going fourth is Benny Parsons. Showing in fifth at the present time is the Neil Bonnet car. And they're switching some positions around. We had a couple of pit stops. Terry Labonte, his 44, had been shown in sixth. The seventh spot was car number nine. The number nine car, Bill Elliott. Eighth is Rutman. Ninth is Bouchard. Dale had been sandwiched back to the 10th position. You may be getting, they have a problem here on the track. They're checking some debris just past the start-finish line. Three of the NASCAR officials are pointing up on the track just down below us to the left, looking at something on the courts.
Cale seemed to have a rather long pit stop then, and he has dropped right to the back of this line.
Now they're cleaning up some debris right here in the tri-oval. You know, three drivers have won their first career victory ever here in the Daytona 500, David. Tiny Lund back in 1963 when he took over for Marvin Panch in the Wood Brothers car. Mario Andretti won it in 67 for the Holman Moody folks. And, of course, Pete Hamilton for Petty Engineering. Wonder if I'd have a surprise here today. Let's go to Ned Jarrett.
We're standing by with Rusty Wallace, who is out of the race. Ken Squire, if we could pull that tape up where he spun over there, we'll let him describe exactly what happened. Rusty, you see yourself going into turn two there now. Tell us.
Well, I think we're a little late on that one, but what happened, getting into it, that's the late part of it. But getting into it, the car was just been running loose all day long. My crew was trying to help me out to try to get me to run a higher groove. I was just running too low of a groove, they thought. I tried to move the groove up and just try to make the car a little bit better, just trying to save it as much as I can because the car was just running so darn loose. But I got up, and then the 89 car, that gold car, was behind me, and it just must have broke the draft on me or broke the rear end loose, and the car just got... I tried to save it because there was a bunch of cars down on the low side of me. I didn't want to spin in front. I didn't want to lock it down to the left and spin and take a couple people with me, so I just tried to hold on as much as I could, and it looks like I pretty well had it. Then it was right at the last minute, just there wasn't no saving it. But, in the rookies' meetings, they tell you to lock them down and bring them down to the left, and I thought that as soon as it happened, but I didn't want to take anybody with me, and they were right down the bottom side of me, and that would have been, you know, a bad deal for the 41 car and a couple other cars behind me. So, I don't know. The beginning of the race, we could really run good, but as soon as the tires would give up and the chassis started getting, the springs started getting hot or shocks or whatever, the car just started getting loose. But, beginning of the race, I was real confident we were right up there with the best of them.
Well, it's too bad he's out of it here. He's one of the highly touted rookies on the circuit this year, Ken.
Candidate for Rookie of the Year honors, Rusty Wallace, preparing for a restart.
Oh, a bad start to the season. The car actually wasn't too badly damaged. And
there's your race summary as we get ready for a go. And here you have the two cars out of the same sponsor stable up in front. One car a lap down, Ricky Rudd on the inside, and on the outside it is the Dale Earnhardt car, number three, that leads the event. And at the second position, you see Waltrip's car. Our in-car camera's down for just a moment. In the third position, number 90, Richard Brooks, who won one Grand National race at the world's fastest motor speedway in Talladega, Alabama. He is in third. The green is out and on the brake. Place car is Benny Carson. Leo Jackson prepared, number 55, which has been running some amazing laps in the last 3 or 4 days in crimping for this 500. Black and white, number 55, in fourth spot is Carson, the 1975 winner of this race.
And going low is young Bonnet. One of those two.
Side of the racetrack, pulling, getting a good shot. That is Bonnet coming all the way up in the bottom, and here is Cale Yarborough trying to hustle out from that traffic. He's way back. Cale Yarborough well back, shown 10th overall on the list as they get ready for the start. And some lap traffic there with him, including David Pearson directly in front of him.
Yeah, now he is a long way back. His biggest fear at this stage is that front trio or a front quartet there is going to break away, which it looks as if they're starting to do already, and leave him high and dry, or high and draftless.
Well, Neil Bonnet went from fifth up into the lead in that shot. Now, and here, pictures from Neil Bonnet's car is up the inside. Comes Terry Labonte for the lead. Whoop! Earnhardt's there, too.
And Yarborough.
Well, there's a quick way to lose three positions. Back they come. 107 laps complete this time by. 93 to go. Labonte leading. Earnhardt second. Waltrip back to third. And the team cars from Junior Johnson and Warner Hodgson Stables run third and fourth.
Sponsor will be quite pleased with this.
I might imagine.
I wonder.
take a look at 9th and 10th place for just a moment. There's Rutman falling back a little. Bill Elliott there. And there's Ron Bouchard still holding on. He is the 9th place car. Trying to move under Joe Rutman in the 98. Ricky Rudd is there a lap down. And then you see Cale Yarborough.
He's up to 11th spot now.
Yarborough is really having his hands full trying to get unsorted here and move through traffic. And he does not want those leaders to break away. Ourselves a dandy race, 107 laps deep. Waltrip has got some fighting to stay up in front, and Yarborough has a real task on his hands. He wants to meander back up there and play with the lead.
Well, he got around Ron Bouchard then. He's hot footing behind this lead group down the back chute, but there is a little bit of a gap developing in front of him, so he needs to try and cover that before it's too late.
Here's Cale making a move, bottom side of the racetrack. Getting underneath the Bud Moore car. And Cale picks up Ricky Rudd. Smoke. And it looks like 55 is off the pace. Denny Parsons slowing down. That's Parsons, bottom of the frame. You see him on the bottom of the racetrack slowing way down.
Well, there was a bit of a puff of smoke. He was right in the middle of that group. He pulled down to the left. Pulled out of the fast line very well.
Denny Parsons, 1975 winner. The year everybody thought that David Pearson had it won. The year that Bobby Allison bought the Matador. Second place for Denny Parsons, 1984. There's not going to be any kind of a replay. Here he is, slowing down, back straightaway. Meanwhile, leaders on the east banking, Terry Labonte, the Texas driver, stays in front. Earnhardt is right there with him.
We seem to be having a lot of engine problems today. It may be that they don't allow for quite such warm weather. The crew chiefs and these cars aren't really getting quite cool enough there. It's a possibility.
Six car leads last. Running in six is number 9, Bill Elliott.
If Benny doesn't get the car going, that'll be the fourth straight 500 he's missed.
This will be an appropriate time to take a look at the attrition. Standing by, give us an update on attrition and how it's gone. Here is Mike Joy.
Your passenger car's V8 engine probably never exceeds 4,000 RPM in its lifetime. But today at Daytona, they're turning 8,000 RPMs. And on a hot day like this, those engines are going off like popcorn. Former winners out of the race, A.J. Foyt, Buddy Baker, Bobby Allison, Richard Petty out of the race, and now finally Benny Parsons, mostly due to engine failure. Only four cautions, the last one for Rusty Wallace's crash in turn number 2, the others due to blown engines and oil dumped on the racetrack. With me is Tom Sneva, the Indy winner. He was here earlier in the week trying to qualify for this 500, met with the wall in turn number 2, but it's good to hear that just yesterday or the day before, you signed your deal, you will be at Indianapolis.
Well, we sure will. We'll be back in the Texaco Star, and I was real excited to see Richard run as strong as he did because he was in very much the same situation, a lot of turmoil, some changes late. He put his program together, and I was glad to see that. We're looking forward to Indianapolis. We would have liked to have been out here, but, you know, we tried to wax the wall with a Simonized car on Thursday and didn't make it.
You've been a keen observer. Who looks good to you?
I'll tell you, if the track gets as greasy as Cale was talking about earlier, I think the Fords are going to come to the front. So there's two little Fords out there with Dick Brooks and Bill Elliott, and I think towards the end of the race, you might see those Fords close to the front.
Thoughts of the Indy champion, a spectator here at Daytona. Ken?
All right, Mike, 111 laps complete, 89 to go, and here's Cale Yarborough in a battle, bottom of the racetrack. Pulls up, takes a good look at Neil Bonnett. How do you do?
I'll have a cool one, please.
Comes down to the inside. He's trying to move under Neil Bonnett. They go to turn 3. And you can see the camera in Bonnett's car. They could look back and forth at each other here. And there is a look back at Cale. How do you do? Nice afternoon. Having a wonderful time. Wish you were not here.
Yeah, exactly. I wish I was out here on my own.
There's Cale pulling right up as they go to turn 1.
Cale looking in the mirror there. We can see him glancing up into that mirror to see where Dick Brooks is hiding in the Ford. It's interesting what Tom Sneva said about the Ford, because Buddy Baker was only telling me this morning that he felt the Ford really could outhandle any car here, and he was looking forward to getting comfortable towards the end of the race. Unfortunately, Buddy is now out, but Dick Brooks is very much in.
That's a battle for 4th and 5th that you're taking a gander at between Bonnet and Yarborough. Here's the lead once again, and Earnhardt is sticking the Ford's nose back in the lead. The Thunderbird continuing to fly. I beg your pardon. Chevrolet. Bound to do that. You see it as yellow and blue. It's got to be a Bud Moore car. Not true. Chevrolet that comes out of the Richard Childress stable.
11 and 12 there, giving each other a really hard time. Those two teammates, they come through the triangle and into turn one. There they are, glued together as they go through turns one and two. Car number 51 on pit road, Greg Sachs. New York, tire change, gas.
Back straight away. Moving up and on the inside, there goes Neil Bonnet back to work another time, and here comes Yarborough flying on the outside. Back inside Cale's car, he's closed up on number 44, the Dale Inman prepared car, being driven by the Texas driver, Terry Labonte. We'll be back with more of the Daytona 500 in a moment. The Goodyear Blimp Enterprise. You're watching an 11-car draft for the lead. Coming through the tri-oval, completing 117 of the 200 laps. And Cale Yarborough has fought his way back in front. You see Earnhardt running in second. And you're looking back from Cale Yarborough's car at the second place Chevrolet of Dale Earnhardt. And then in third, it is Neil Bonnet, in fourth is Terry Labonte, and maintaining the fifth position is Darrell Walter. Here is Ned Jarrett with the 1975 Daytona 500 champion.
Benny Parsons, and he's out of it here. Why, Benny?
Something happened to the engine, Ned. I really don't know exactly what. I will speculate that probably a cylinder head caved in. I've had it happen before, and it's something similar to what happened this time.
How are you feeling about your chances?
Well, I've been having some problems. I can run good for about 8 or 10 laps, then the car would get a little bit loose. In other words, the back end would start sliding up the hill. But we were still in the same lap. We were still in the lead draft. If we could have adjusted on a little bit more and got it better for the last 100 miles of the race, who knows? We might have won this thing.
Who do you see as the man to beat out there now?
I don't know. It looks Earnhardt has shown surprising strength all day. Cale Yarborough naturally has been strong all day. Those two cars right now, to me, would be the favorites.
Now let's go up on pit road to Chris Economak.
Well, there's an unusual calm prevailing in Neil Bonnet's pit. You can see the men standing around. It doesn't look like he's going for the lead on the track. Junior Johnson up there, as calm as can be. They had a problem with the car, a vibration. It was cured when the tire was changed. Everything is well, but there's really no excitement and no emotion here. Ken?
Let's review a little bit further back in the field. As we look out at Neil Bonnet's car running in that third position, there's the leader, Cale Yarborough. The sixth place overall in the field is now number 90, Richard Brooks. Brooks maintaining sixth. Seventh is Bill Elliott. Eighth is Ron Bouchard. Ninth is the Joe Rutman car, number 98. The 10th position is car number 33, Harry Gant. 11th is the rookie, Greg Sachs. Going 12th is Ricky Rudd. 13th is the brother of Benny Parsons, Bill Parsons. 14th is David Pearson. 15th is Bodine. 16th is Means. 17th is Ridley. 18th at the present time, Sterling Marlin. 19th is Pond. And Reagan runs in 20th. Here's the Heverin car coming back on pit road another time. Running 21st on the track is Roper. 22nd is Arrington. 23rd right now is Connie Saylor, who replaced Graham Adcox. Adcox broke a finger yesterday, and Connie Saylor took over in his car. 24th is Mike Alexander. 25th is Dean Combs. And 26th right now is a youngster, Clark Dwyer. Here's your leader. It remains Cale Yarborough's race to win. Can he do it and become a four-time winner? We'll know before too long. Back with more live coverage of Daytona after this word from your local. Cale Yarborough with a hard-bitted steed, number 28, is beginning to walk away from the field. He's now picked up about a 15-car length advantage. Seems to be breaking the draft on the second-place car, Dale Earnhardt, with Neil Bonnet running fourth. And there you see the interval right from Cale's car as he sees it in his rearview mirror. And right now, Earnhardt's pulling up a little. Taking a look further back, there's Joe Rutman in car number 98, now being shown in the ninth position, directly in front of him. In eighth position, number 47, that is Ron Bouchard. And now taking a look at seventh position, there you see Bill Elliott, right in front of Bouchard.
That's another of those Fords that Tom Sneaver thought might show well towards the end of this race. And we'll see. Cale Yarber at the moment is showing extremely strongly.
Cale Yarber. Now you see Rutman still back there in ninth on the tail end of the draft. Yarber first won this race, 1968. Came back and won it in 77, then won it last year. Now can he do it back to back? Petty wants to do back to back. If he does it, he'll be the first man in history to win the Daytona Triple Crown, to take the pole on pole position day 7 days ago, the fastest car in qualifying, to then come back and win the 125-mile qualifying race and go on to win the 500. And from these pictures, you get an idea of the throng that is here. Fireball Robert did it in 1962 on the Triple Crown. Yarborough could be only the second man in history to do it.
Those shots just then gave you an idea of the fantastic crowd here. Obviously, Cale Yarborough will be hoping to win this race because he'll run it in front of more people than he's probably ever raced against, raced in front of before. It's interesting that Cale is pulling away like he did in the qualifying race on Thursday. At this stage, it's a bit early to show his hand, but it could be that he's just trying to see if he can break that lead draft. If he can, he knows he's in very, very good shape.
There he is, skimming around Ronnie Thomas once again. And those privateers trying so hard to make it all work.
Bunch of lap traffic there, getting in with that lead group as they come into the tri-oval.
126 laps now complete. Only 74 to go. Cale is building a little bit of a cushion here. There you see the speed in the last lap at 190 miles an hour, and you can look back with him and feel a little comfortable. Nobody breathing on his rear bumper at the moment.
Oh, by this relative term, that is. I mean, how far are they behind him in seconds?
That's,
I mean,
a big interval here.
Blink of an eyelid.
There you see the third place car. Back with the leader. Harry Gantz, number 33, loads up and comes down on the inside. He's been picking up some cars. He's running right in front of the Ricky Rudd car.
Harry Gantz being on the same lap as the leader, but putting a lap down on Ricky Rudd, who is a lap down.
He is being shown in 10th position. There's Doug Heverin's car being lapped again by Cale Yarborough.
He's now got over a second, over a 1 second lead to the second car.
Fourth in the all-time win list, Cale Yarborough at 78. All-time winner, Petty, as we mentioned earlier, 198. Then David Pearson at 105. And Bobby Allison with 79 wins. He has retired from the event. Take a look at this. Those folks are really enjoying their stay in Florida.
All getting a good suntan today, too. Well, the cloud cover is keeping the heat off the track, so it may not get too much worse than it's been because of the heat.
Yarborough's lead is now stabilized to just a little over a second from the second and third place car. And Bonnet has to get in a real tight draft with Dale Earnhardt if he hopes to overcome. It's beginning to be a cushion for Cale Yarborough that he sits on very comfortably in this Daytona 500. Just 69 laps remain in the 1984 Daytona 500 with Cale Yarborough out in front. We've taken you inside the cars, inside the garage and the pit areas. Let's take you inside some of the other facets that are interesting here at Daytona. And entertainment comes in many phases. Here's Chris Economaki.
Well, I'm in the Goodyear Tower where the president of the Goodyear Tire and Rubber Company has his corporate guests and business customers. Lovely ladies are here. We've just had some great food, a catered luncheon, a classified 1961 Groves, and Ozzie Olsen, Roger Penske, and other people are here looking at the competition on the track. It's really the great way to see the Daytona 500. Ned?
We're in the International Games Building just up pit road. Now, they can look out of here and see the cars come by. Of course, they can see a lot of the pit action, but you can see they have a nice shish kebab here cooked up with all the trimmings, everything that you need to go with it. They sit around and play a little Uno if things get dull, which we haven't seen so far here today. And this is the good old middle of the road American crowd. Of course, they got their beer here, whatever it takes to make them happy. We got a complete family type situation here in this building. So it just goes to show that Stock car racing is the American game today. Now let's go back to Chris.
Well, having looked at the tower here and at the selection in the Uno room, I'd say that both meals get a 2 rating. Stars here and Alka-Seltzer there. Back to you, Ken.
He won't be invited back. 133 laps are now complete. And we have 2 cars on pit road. Here's Ronnie Thomas just coming in. I think Mike Alexander as well. It could have been Buddy Arrington's Chrysler car there on the bottom of your frame. Only lone Chrysler product for Mr. Iacocca out here today. A staunch supporter. Buddy Arrington out of Martinsville, Virginia. The only man to fly their colors in the 1984 Daytona 500. Now you're looking at Cale Yarborough another time.
Cale Yarborough, I would have thought that he'd have been better off in the draft in that lead group than out on his own, because he's pushing a lot more air, and that would be using more fuel.
Look at the vibration in that car.
There you can see his foot squirming around on that right pedal as he goes into turn one, and you can see the vibration coming up through the gear shift too.
He's been racing here since 1962.
All the gauges look all right. He's got a crack in the left side of his windscreen there, coming out of that stone chip in the left corner, and it's spreading across the screen. But those upright posts will hold that screen in place. I don't think there's any danger of it blowing out. But you can see those chips getting worse and worse as the day goes on.
Now, they should be pitting within 5 laps. Those leaders should come in within 5 laps. We are at lap 135 as they work right now. Definitely trying to build up a cushion here. There's 7th, 8th, and 9th. Going down at turn 1, that's Bill Elliott. Ron Bouchard's having a great day. Beatty car, and right behind him comes Joe Ruttman. Remember, Ruttman was 4th a year ago. He was 3rd the previous year. And the Dr. Benfield car stays right in the hunt this year. So the leaders already on pit road. The activity is building. Now, Jarrett, Chris Economaki, you'll have to give up the lunches and head back to work in the pits. We'll see you in a moment live from Daytona. Leaders have pitted. The leaders have all been on pit road. And you are now with Neil Bonnet. We believe that he is in the 2nd position. Number 9, Bill Elliott, has not pitted. And Elliott may be pitting this time around. And if so, he would give Neil Bonnet 1st place. He's coming to the start-finish line area. 138 laps have been completed. Yarborough has been in. And immediately after him came the rest of the entourage. It was Dale Earnhardt in. Now you're looking at number 12. This is Neil Bonnet, the Warner Hodgson Jr. Johnson car. And there is the Dale Earnhardt car, number 3. Made a very good pit stop. Number 33, number 9 has been leading. He has just pulled on pit road. Number 9 is on pit road. That was Bill Elliott, who inherited the lead in this rash of pit stops. Jody Redley is in. Joe Ruttman is also on pit road. And Harry Gant, as you see in your picture, the bottom of it there, he's come in. Coming out now is the Bill Elliott car. And then the being pushed, rolling, is Joe Ruttman. Right in front of him, Jody Redley, still being worked on, cleaning off the front of his car. Ruttman having a terrible time on pit road. It looks like he's lost a gear, David.
Yeah, he's been in there for nearly a minute now, one way or another, trying to get out. Dale Earnhardt's pit crew yet again did a heck of a time. He was only in for 13 seconds. Cale was in for 16 and a half. Number 12 was in for 17. That's Neil Bonnet. So that means that Dale Earnhardt could have sneaked out about a 3-second lead there.
Car number 33, Harry Gant, for just a moment had the lead as a pit stop period is coming under green. When they come by this time, they will have completed 140 laps, leaving 60 remaining.
There we have the position. I think that we've got Dale Earnhardt being closely followed by Darrell Waltrip. I'm pretty sure that they're now 1st and 2nd after that rash of pit stops.
Indeed, that is the case. There are your leaders.
And 3rd will be Dick Brooks in the 4th, but not far behind them.
Brooks has had a terrific day.
He had a good stop too.
Back straight away. Waltrip, just one day ago, they ran the 300-mile sportsman race yesterday, and he won it. Won it from 4th position with about 2 laps to go. He did not look impressive. He didn't do anything that would give any indication that he was ready to be in the hunt at the end, and then all of a sudden, he bit down hard and
flew past Sammy Ard and Neil Bonnet and charged home to take the win.
There he is taking the lead for the first time today. Darrell Waltrip,
lap 141. 141, Waltrip, who has never won this race. He's won 57 Grand National races. He has twice been the national champion, but he's never won Daytona. Here comes Yarborough, moving beneath the Chevrolet number 3 of Dale Earnhardt.
As you can see from that in-car camera, Cale's car has now got the wood finish inside. They've got a veneer finish to add a bit of class to that car, and the mechanics are very proud of it.
Nevertheless, $65,000 for a car you have to crawl in and out of the
door windows. Even open.
No air conditioner, no radio. Not much of a bargain. We'll be back with more in a moment from Daytona. We've checked the culinary delights of the Daytona Speedway. Now you're looking at high fashion for a 2.5 mile track. With a busy group of folks today stitching jackets here below the grandstand. Back to the race at lap 145 in this 200-lap race. Cale Yarborough has reappropriated the lead. Yarborough is in first. There you see the number 11 car of Darrell Waltrip running in the second position at still over 190 miles per hour. In third, here comes Dale Earnhardt. Running fourth is the number 90 car, all four running together. Richard Brooks is there. So and Chevrolets are 1, 2, 3.
And about 3 seconds behind Richard Brooks is Terry Labonte on a bit of a lonely run. And about another 3.5 seconds behind him is Neil Bonnet.
There's Labonte in that position unto himself. Fifth spot, closing on a lap car, Hebron. Terry Labonte in number 44. Now a spot in back of him in the sixth position now. We would see, as he laps this man on the back straightaway, there's Terry Labonte, your fifth place car. Should be car number 12, Neil Bonnet. And there is Bonnet, closing on Greg Sachs, putting him another lap down. The man on the point remains Cale Yarborough. Here's Neil Bonnet, lapping this man on the inside, attempting to get underneath Greg Sachs. Say goodbye. Neil Bonnet, in one of the Junior Johnson Warner Hodgson cars, trying to move up through and move back up with that front block of automobiles, battling for this million-dollar payoff in the Daytona 500 back straightaway. There you see Yarborough, and there you see Waltrip, 1 and 2.
Yarborough is still lapping at round about 193.5 miles an hour consistently. And they are, in fact, this front trio, our front quartet, are pulling away slightly from Terry Labonte.
Waltrip in second place. He's had one runner-up finish in this event, that in 1981. He's had 3 fourth place finishes here. He's trying to win it for the first time. He's won just about everything else. He has been the winning driver the last 3 or 4 years. 12 races one season, 12 races another, 7 this past year. Here they are in the back straightaway. Yarborough trying to hold on to win his fourth one. We'll be back with more live coverage of the Daytona 500 after this word from your local station. It's just out. Joe Ruttmann has crashed in turns 3 and 4. He is all right, being extricated from his car. Let's go right to Ned Jarrett.
Darrell Waltrip is taking advantage of this caution period for a four-tire change. They've already changed to the right side. Now they come around to the left side. And now let's go up to Chris Economak.
Cale Yarborough is doing the same thing. He's been in the pits 20 seconds now, and they're working on the inside tires. But this pit stop is not late enough in the race to mean he can go the distance. There has to be one more pit stop for fuel. Back to you, Ned.
Well, Waltrip has finished his. Let's see, as they race down pit road, which of those drivers can get out first?
Well, there you see the Yarborough car, and moving around him, the Wrangler machines as they get ready to go again. Here is Ruttmann out of his car and walking away. Joe Ruttmann, who was a fourth and third place finisher the last 2 years respectively and only his third Daytona 500, carrying the number 98 that his brother Troy Ruttmann carried to Daytona 500, or their Indianapolis 500-mile victory back in the 50s. Spinning down to the bottom of the track. He was running 2 laps down. As you recall, he had some problems on pit road. And he has a skirmish with the wall in turns 3 and 4.
that put Joe Ruttman out of it today. So Joe Ruttman is out, fifth caution. It will once again gather all eight cars in the lead lap back together for another assault on the 1984 Daytona 500. Well, there you see the leaderboard for the event next on CBS today, the LA Open from the Riviera Country Club. David Edwards is one under, and you see the bear Jack Nicklaus is on the prowl once again. That's coming up later today here on CBS Sports. Let's take a look at a replay as we continue live coverage of the 1984 Daytona 500. Cale Yarborough leaving the pits there, David, and Neil Bonnett right behind him seems interested in having a few things move.
Yeah, like those two big tires right in his way. You'll see his car will bump down off the jack any second now, and he can just charge straight out through. There it goes, and off he goes right where those tires were, but he didn't want them just accidentally leaving them there.
Now, there have been situations like that that weren't quite that easy. For instance, the T.O. Fabi situation.
Right, last year, T.O. Fabi in the race at Riverside ran over another crew's airjack hose, and they penalized him a lap, which he felt was very unfair because obviously he had to leave his pit.
Joe Ruttman is out of the race with car number 98. We talk about him as a relative newcomer here in the Daytona 500. He actually drove his first NASCAR race in Riverside, California back in 1963 when he was 18. Finished 10th that day. Of course, he went on and did a lot of racing up in the Michigan area for many years. There is Ruttman's car number 98. Being brought back to the garage area. Hard day for them. So after two good years and two good finishes, Joe Ruttman winds up out of this one very early. We are at lap 152, which means there are 48 laps to go. And they will have to pit one more time to get themselves safely home today.
If they have green from now to the end, it's going to be a very quick green.
Winners from the pole here, there have only been four, and one of them is the man right now who's leading the event, Cale Yarborough, who won it in 68 from the pole. Here's Chris Economaki.
Well, if Neil Bonnett was held at the end of pit road, he's not telling anybody. We just checked with Junior Johnson and his boys about that. And Neil Bonnett is the kind of man, apparently, who likes to suffer in silence. Back to you, Ken.
Wasn't held so much on the end of pit road as he was just a little concerned he might be held up by his leading adversary in the race here. Had some tires out just in front of him, Chris. All right. The break, and as they start, we have Cale in front. Earnhardt is back in second. It is Waldrop in third, who's played it very cautiously, very close to the best all day. The fourth spot remains Richard Brooks, and in fifth is Terry Labonte as they come to speed another time. Just completed the fifth caution of the day from laps 150 to lap 153 under yellow.
And again, Cale asserts that tremendous superiority that his car seems to have had all weekend, and just to prove me a liar, there goes Dale Earnhardt down the inside of Cale Yarborough into turn three.
And here comes Darrell Waltrip to the outside. Waltrip, twice national champion, controversial figure. But when Bobby Allison beat him for the national championship last year, he was very magnanimous. He came right into the pits, and his first stop was in the Allison pits to congratulate them on a job well done. For Bobby Allison, this has been a bitter day. His car number 22 falling by the wayside among 15 cars that have now retired from the 42 that started the Great American Race. It is Yarborough out of turn two, followed by Earnhardt Chevrolet, and then comes that Warner Hodgson Jr. Johnson car. His crew chief, whether the Waltrip crew chief, Hammond on pit road, and the co-car, the number 12 car, their crew chief in the hospital today. There's the number 12 car pulling up for fifth position on number 44. 44 is in fifth, and it is Bonnett's crew chief, Doug Richard, who is watching today from a hospital bed at Halifax Hospital here in Daytona Beach.
Really following closely behind Terry Labonte, and as you realize, they've only just had a pit stop and all those screens have just been cleaned, and that gives you an idea of what they start to get like towards the end of the race.
Give you a headache?
Gives you a headache, and it certainly gives you double vision. I mean, you can see how bad it is when the sun, and the sun starts to get low as well, of course.
We have a bit of a cloud cover today. The temperature just outside of our CBS booth stands at just about 92 degrees. Track temperature well over 100 degrees now. It is one of the warmest 500s. Key cars have had motors expire, including Richard Petty, A.J. Foyt, Buddy Baker out of this race, Benny Parsons, Joe Ruttman. And here's a battle as on the inside, number 33, Gant, the green and white car, is fighting with Ron Bouchard, who gives a little nod to him, motions to him.
Yeah, I saw that. I wonder what that was
about, maybe trying to get Harry Gant to give him a bit of a tow and try and pull themselves back to that lead group, because they are at the moment losing ground.
Here is Ned Jarrett with Joe Rutman.
Joe, you came out of the crash, went into the hospital. Was that just for a checkover?
Yeah, I guess just make sure my heart was still pumping. No, it was a fun ride, but whenever you make contact with the wall, I guess they're concerned to make sure you're all right and make sure your heart's not pumping too fast. I'm sure it's probably ticking a few beats quicker than it should, because it gets your attention when something happens.
Certainly does. What happened?
You know, Ned, at this point, I'm really not sure. It actually felt like maybe we developed a vibration, and my first thought was is maybe it spit the dry shaft out. And when it did, it momentarily locked the rear wheels, and, you know, from then on, I was just hanging on from that point, because hopefully not hitting anything too hard.
Well, Ken, here's a fellow that was right in the picture as we went down to the finish of the Daytona 500 last year, but he won't be today.
And one of the nicest people in the sport. Six cars running a bundle for the lead. Then 15 car lengths back in the seventh position hovers Bill Elliott in car number 9. There's your leader, number 28, Cale Yarborough, working on win number 79. It would tie him with Bobby Allison. Career wins on the Grand National Tour if he can pull this one off. But more important, he would equal the Triple Crown mark that has only been attained by one driver in history, the late Fireball Roberts, 1962, when he won the pole, the qualifier, and went on to take the 500.
And I saw him do all three from right on this very ground, just a boy. Here for the very first running of the Daytona Continental, a three-hour race then, and a 24-hour race now.
Bonnet moving up, not having much luck. Number 44, Labonte pulled away. There you see them, back to three.
Well, these guys at this stage of the game with another 40-odd laps, well, less than 40-odd laps to go.
Oh, car spinning. It is Richard Brooks in trouble. He's getting hit and slammed into by Ron Bouchard. Out of control, he's still sliding and spinning out of turn four.
Wow.
A Labonte corner claims another.
What a lucky boy he was there. Nobody really tagged him too hard. Ron Bouchard is desperately unlucky to have just hit him. And he was very lucky that he didn't get hit harder in that particular situation.
Richard Brooks.
What a shame, because he was running so well in that Chameleon car.
In trouble with the Juni Donlevy car spinning and getting collected by number 47, Ron Bouchard. He was blessed. Critical point of the racetrack, where we've had such disasters in the past 7 days. Interestingly enough, the first Grand National race this man, Richard Brooks, ever saw was the 1969 Daytona 500. And would you believe it? He watched it from behind the wheel of an old Plymouth. Brooks finished 32nd in that race that year. Thought he'd come out here and see what it looked like.
Well, he's going to finish a lot further down than that this year. I feel very sorry for Juni Donlevy, his crew chief and owner, who is such a nice gentleman. And here we're going to see a bit of a rush down pit lane. Obviously, everybody's going to top up, but there's still too many laps to go for these guys to finish it off.
40 laps to go. We can look at it from several angles as to exactly what has happened to bring out the sixth caution of the day. Let's take a look at these pictures first. On a wide angle shot, the car just broke away.
It looks like a left front tire.
A tire may have broken loose.
Bill Elliott luckily scraping by there. Ron Bouchard not being so lucky.
No place to go.
Frontal impact on both cars is really, by and large, the best you can hope for, actually, I should think.
I'll tell you, there should be some pictures here from our cameraman, Joe Sakota, who is right at that critical part of turn four. This is from Joe Sakota's camera, right in turn four, and you're right in it. They're coming right at him. I'll tell you, when they give out the Emmys, Sakota, the pictures he has taken out of turn four of this racetrack for the last 3 years have been just amazing.
Now you can see why he wears goggles and a crash helmet.
He wears
too.
A flak jacket and a helmet. Now from the blimp, let's take a look at what happened. Here we go, and it sure looks like a tire got cut down there.
Okay, would you like to see it one more way? What about from the in-car camera, David? We may find out that it is a tire down if the in-car camera can capture that for us.
There we see him. Terry Labonte in front, and then right in front of him is Dick Brooks. You've got an absolutely perfect view. That's him, the car on the left there.
One.
Yep. It looks to me like the tire just lets go.
Or was it just oil spewing out from the headers and he got into his own oil and came around? The way it exploded, I thought it was the left side tire. That looked like the right, David.
The camera car just missing the action there.
We could look at it again. It's incredible how the dice fall in a game like this. Now, here's the other in-car camera.
Yeah, maybe his engine does let go, because it definitely comes out of the left front first, doesn't it? Smoke definitely comes out of the left front
first. As if he's pouring oil down to those rear tires. He runs into his own oil, and then he's away for a very slippery ride. Those things aren't built to be figure skaters.
Well, that speed, they're not.
And here comes 47 into him right about now.
Well, I don't think you're going to get a better view of a racing accident than that lot. Two in-car cameras, a blimp, close up.
George Graffio controlling one of those in-car cameras that gave you those pictures. Here is Ned Jarrett with Ron Bouchard.
Well, we have Dick Brooks and Ron Bouchard here that was involved in that accident. First, if we can get the accident back up on the screen, Ken, we'll get Brooks, since he was the one that appeared to be spinning first. Here he comes, Dick. Can you tell us what happened?
Yeah, it blowed up. I don't know what happened. Something broke, and it fluttered. It just fluttered, and then just the rear wheels locked up, and that was the end of it. I sure hate that for Ron. I tried to keep it down. I had the brakes locked up there, but it just, it was just too far off the turn. But
when you saw Ron Bouchard coming towards you there, what did you feel?
Well, I didn't see him. I saw the smoke. I never did see him at all until he hit me, but I did see some those guys go by.
Well, here we come from another angle now, and we'll turn over to Ron Bouchard as they come around. Okay, Ron, now you're seeing Brooks in front of you starting that spin. Your thoughts as you begin to come into the picture now.
Yes, I see Dick when he blew up, and, everything was so close, and I had Harry right beside of me, and I couldn't move to the outside, and then it just got so smoky, I couldn't see where he was, and I hit him right in the middle of the smoke.
Not a thing in the world a man can do in a case like that.
No, that's for sure. There's no way to slow him down. We're running so fast, and, when you can't see where you're going, you got problems.
Okay, Dick, here we are from the in-car camera from behind you. That's Bonnet's car.
See where it blew up? I don't know what it was. It just blowed out both sides. I'll tell you, we was running good, though. We had the car hooked up really great. I think that, we just kind of biding our time. Cale was awful strong, but when Petty went out, well, that left the race for about anybody else. So
this is from Cale Yarborough's car that we were seeing right there.
Yeah, well, Cale's strong, though. He'll still get back up in there, but that's a shame, man. I'll tell you, we had such a good run here last year and was having a good run this year. I don't know. We got to get it fixed.
Well, we're glad to see that you're okay, but tough luck for both of you here today, Ron. Sorry about that.
Thank you very much, Ned.
Well, as we see Brooks' car there for the final time as he spins down, the caution still out. Now let's go back to Ken Squire.
So for Richard Brooks, his best finish has been in 1973 when he placed third on this track, and he's had 3 fifth-place finishes, and it looked like it was going to be better today. It was not to be.
Well, we got oil on the track at the crash site, along with quite a bit of debris, I should think. And an interesting point is that Cale went 38 laps before making his first pit stop. And there's 41 left to go now. So it's going to be a real close run to the flag.
It's a game for gamblers at this point, and the gamblers are on pit road, checking on fuel consumption. Back with more in a moment. There remain 37 laps at this point, 92 and a half miles in the 1984 Daytona 500. Cale Yarborough, will you pull back and draft behind Waltrip rather than lead here and try to save a little fuel? He's driving by the crash site now of car number 90, Richard Brooks. Cale Yarborough, do you hear me? Cale Yarborough, Ken Squire, do you hear me?
Go ahead, Ken.
Cale, will you continue? You're in second place, and with the laps running out, there's about 92 miles to go now, and try to save some fuel.
Well, yeah, I'm going to have to think what I got to do here now. We can't run quite that far on back of fuel, so I got to figure out what I got to do to save the fuel.
What is the range on your car? How far can you go?
We can go 36 laps.
36 laps. So one more lap, and if you could top your tank, you would go home.
Well, we're thinking right now if we can make a pit stop here before the green comes back out, cropping it off and starting in the rear and try to come back up to the front.
Thank you, Dale. When they come by this time, 165 laps will be completed. There will be 35 laps, 87 and a half miles to go. And David, they're within range of the checkered flag.
Yeah, well, after this long caution, they are now within range. If they, apart from else, just going slowly like this, they haven't used much fuel, but they could go in and top off now because they're going to have plenty of time now.
So our CBS coverage will be focusing briefly on pit road here because they should be coming in quickly, topping the tanks and putting their drivers back out. There you see Cale with his arm out trying to get an extra scoop of air inside the car.
Yeah, because it is pretty hot in there today. If it's 90 up here, it's about 125 inside that car. And any air you can get in is very welcome. But you can't put your hand out when you're doing 190 because it pulls it off.
Waltrip is in front, trying to win that first Daytona 500. He's been very easy all week, hasn't had too much to say. But yesterday, when it counted, he came through and won the prelude to this event, the sportsman race, the Goodies 300. Darrell Waltrip, the most proficient winner. Here come all the leaders. On to pit road.
Darrell not coming in. No, not the leader. Not the leader.
It's a couple of lap cars. They may wait a lap. Now, they may have trapped themselves because they're showing one lap to go. One lap, and they're going to turn them loose.
I think that caught them by surprise. I think they were thinking there'd be at least two to go.
Well, we ought to get some reports from the pits because this may change the story dramatically here. Here's Ned Jarrett.
We're standing by with Jeff Hammond, the crew chief on Darrell Walker's pit. Can you make it from here on?
Yes, Ned, we got a full tank fuel at that time. We've been getting real good gas mileage about all day, so with the amount of caution laps we've been running here the last few minutes, we can go all the way.
Well, now, many of the cars did choose to come in and top their tanks off. You didn't?
No, we got everything figured pretty close, but right now we can go all the way, and we prefer to stay up front.
Very confident, as you can tell. Now let's go to Chris Economak, who is with Waddell Wilson.
Well, Waddell's standing a few feet away, but they just jumped up in the air because they've hung the yellow flag out again. Waddell, they're going to go around one more time, or will you have a chance to stop?
No, we're going to stop this time and top the car off so we can make it the rest of the way.
Okie doke. There you have it from Cale Yarborough's crew chief. It looked for a moment as though the race would get the green flag this time by, but such is not the case, Ken.
Indeed, that is the story. They had put out one lap to go. They had a one-lap indicator on the field. Now they are taking an additional lap. And for Yarborough, that'll be a break. He will pit and come in, and then he'll probably be on the back of that lead lap. We'll check the other cars that feel that they're within range of the checkered flag from here. The situation is there are 165 laps complete. When they come by this time, there will be 166 laps complete. 415 miles will have been run. 34 laps, 85 miles remaining.
Say it again. Well, that's a bit of a break for Darrell, but on the other hand, he did in fact do 38 laps on his first stint, not 36, so he probably could have seen this race out.
Now what's happening is in turn four, they are spreading that oil dry, that kitty litter they put down to pick up, and the fluids that have been dropped from a car. And we're watching Cale Yarborough come in right behind Ken Reagan. That's number 77, Reagan. You're inside Cale's car. Here's Chris Economaki.
Okay, Cale is brought to a stop. It's gas and windshield. We've got a stopwatch on him. The rocky thing. There he goes. 5.59 one-hundredths of a second. 5.6 in round numbers for Cale Yarborough. In and out. Fuel and a windshield cleaning. And that's the last this crew will see of Cale unless they visit him in victory lane. Yeah.
Or the garage yard. 166 laps complete.
Don't be a downer.
One lap to green, they're saying. Well, this one has popped the engines on so many leading candidates to win it today. Getting set for a start. Now back on the 150 lap rundown. 90 Richard Brooks was running the tail end of the lead lap, and we had at that time eight cars in the lead lap. We now have six as cars number 90 and 47 have been retired. A lap down in the seventh position will be Jeff Bodine. In the eighth position now is Ricky Rudd. In the ninth position, Phil Parsons. And as we get ready to resume, 10th position is David Pearson. 11th position, Ridley. Getting set to go here once again. Punching the field up. There you see David Pearson. 1976 winner down on the inside. Silver Fox, who's won 105 races. Ageless.
Quite honestly, the adrenaline and the heartbeat will be more now than it was at the beginning of this race, because this really is it. We're now talking about a 50-lap sprint. 50-mile sprint.
Six cars, all in the fight to win the Daytona 500. The green is out. The leader coming to the line is number 11, Walton. Terry Labonte is second. Neil Bonnet is in third. Running in fourth is Harry Gant. And the Hal Needham team, number 33, has been up all day. The fifth spot, which they go down, I believe, should be number 9. Elliott.
Bill Elliott did a chassis adjustment on his car during that last round of pit stops in the course. And he's been running right there with the lead pack all day. Can he improve on last year's finish, where we saw him come that incredibly close second and maybe even win this race as a last-minute upset?
As issue is Cale Yarborough having to fight his way out of lap cars who are blocking just in front of him. Now there's Cale. And right on the inside is a lap car. They go through the speedy dry that's just been laid down for that collision. Bill Elliott is running just in front. Cale tries to dip underneath him as they come out of the tri-oval. Yarborough working Elliott on the inside, and he has it. Just going by him. He closes up on Jeff Bodine. Lap car Bodine directly in front of Yarborough as he continues his assault on the summit here in the Daytona 500. Leaders back straight away. Waltrip, the 11. The blue and white 44, Terry Labonte.
Waltrip and Labonte have made a break from the rest of the field. They're getting on for a second and a half in front of third spot.
Let's go quickly to Ned Jarrett.
Ken, we talked with Jeff Hammond, the crew chief from Waltrip's car, a little bit ago. He was confident they could make it. They didn't come in, and one reason they didn't is Darrell's wife, Stevie, is charting the gas mileage here in the pit. And Stevie, if he doesn't make it, it all falls on your shoulders. Is that right?
That's the way they've got it figured. If he runs out of gas, they're going to put it all on me, but he's not going to. We're getting excellent gas mileage today.
Well, there's further confidence in this pit.
Gracious. A lot of pressure there. Lose the race and serve the papers on Monday.
Meanwhile, Cale Yarborough is up to fourth spot, having just disposed of Dale Earnhardt. Making ground on car number... What car number is that? That is Harry Gant.
Yarborough is now showing the horsepower that Waddell Wilson developed. There he goes by the bandit, Harry Gant. The Waddell Wilson prepared car is flying. On pit road is Neil Bonnet. Bonnet is on pit road. Number 12, Bonnet, comes in. You're with him. Heartbreaker for here. Here's Chris.
With the left side tires here, and this whatever chance he had of winning now is out. He just ejects the cold drink, and the crew is working hard. There he goes. Heartbreak for Neil Bonnet, who was in the hunt for the victory. Down here.
170 laps complete. 30 to go. Waltrip is in front. Terry Labonte is in second. Neither man has ever won the Daytona 500. Closing ground. Third place man. At the present time is Dale Earnhardt's number 3. But here comes Cale Yarborough out of fourth as we get down to the decision. Blimp Enterprise, these pictures in the waning moments of the 1984 Daytona 500. Cale Yarborough, you're with him. He's come all the way back to second place. There, lying in front of him, Darrell Waltrip. Waltrip has had the most terrible luck in this race. He's never finished better than fifth, and that was in 79. Correction, in 79, he finished on 7 cylinders and was able to come in behind Richard Petty. Other than that, he just hasn't been around very often at the end of these things. But here he is out in front. The Warner Hodgson Junior Johnson car is leading. Cale just collected them, David, as he came up through, and he brought number 33, Harry Gant, into fourth place.
Well, Cale was nearly 2 seconds behind his leading group, and as you say, one of the cars he passed, one of his victims was Harry Gant, who tagged on as the only one that could actually hold with him. And he's dragged him up, so he's now got 4 cars dueling it out here for the end of this race. Dale Earnhardt is now making slow ground on them, as is Bill Elliott in the Ford, the one remaining competitive Ford out there. So we're going to end up with a 6-car draft by the end of this, and there'll be 6 cars together.
caution coming through the tri-oval. The car smoking a lot through the tri-oval, and yellow is out. Caution is out for this car. Chrysler, let's go.
Neil Bonnet's prayer is answered. Neil Bonnet crossing the line now can put a lap back on the lead group, and he can join in that six-car draft for the lead.
He's going to put Bonnet right back in it. Darrell Waltrip in his 12th Daytona 500.
You often wonder if they get these guys, pay these guys to blow these engines at a crucial time.
Okay. 67, slowing down. Here's Chris Economaki.
Junior Johnson did some things a moment ago that a kid does when he goes to work for the first time in a gas station. He swept up, and then he wiped windshield because Neil Bonnet was behind an accident. And then after the green flag, Neil Bonnet's car had a soft left rear tire, came in the pits, and was 99% of a lap behind. And this yellow flag is now going to let Neil Bonnet go around and get on the back and add to the excitement of the finish here. And now down to you, Ned.
We're standing in Terry Labonte's pits where Dale Inman, the crew chief, is waiting for him to come in. They plan a four-tire change, and I suspect that we'll see all of these front runners come in and put on four new tires and take on a full tank of fuel. They were not concerned about the fuel, but they'll put those fresh tires on because they're cooler, will adhere to the track a little bit better, give them a better shot at running for the Roses as we get down near the end of this one, Ken.
The only Chrysler product in the field. Buddy Arrington, let's go at 176 laps. The laps remaining now stand at 24.
Harry Gantin, Skull Bandit, number 33, decides to make his tire change now. The others stay out.
Waltrip stays in front. Yarborough stays second. Terry Labonte maintaining third. This will bring Earnhardt up to fourth. Also on pit road is Bill Elliott. Here's Chris.
Harry Gantin, it's a cool, calm, and collected Skull Bandit through the changing of right side tires for Harry Gantin. Very careful on the windshield. The sun is setting now. Getting down into turn one is quite a glare. The nuts are being loosened on the left-hand wheels. NASCAR regulations permit only one jack to be used, so the exercise has to be complete on one side before it begins on the other side. It adds to the length of time that the cars stay at rest in the pit. And okay, Harry Gantin, back in the competition.
And he is in the hunt to win this one today, Chris. Harry Gantz staying right up there with the leaders throughout the afternoon. Neil Bonnet is back in the pits another time. What a break for Bonnet. He will now be a serious factor to win this 26th Daytona 500. Live today on CBS. Later this year, we'll take you to Michigan International Speedway and to Talladega, Alabama, the latter part of July for the Talladega 500. And in 1984, the International Race of Champions returns, and you'll see it on CBS. Let's see if Waltrip will gamble here and bring the car in. Safety car has them in tow out of turn four.
A lot of oil and a lot of kitty litter, as you'd call it, down here in the tri-oval, so that'll make that a bit slippery the first time around.
This time by 178 laps, 445 miles complete, 22 laps to go. Just 22 laps to the decision on the 1984 Daytona 500. Stay with us for the finish. There are six cars in the lead lap as we come down to the finish. The most cars in the lead lap previously to come to the wire were five cars in 1981 when they were led by Richard Petty with Bobby Allison, then in second, Ricky Rudd third, Buddy Baker fourth, Dale Earnhardt fifth. There you are with Cale Yarborough, and there's the butterfly for good luck there on the dash. Cale, Ken Squire again at CBS Race Control. Can you talk to us?
Yeah, go ahead, Ken.
Okay, now how do you feel about it from here on in? Have you got the horses to contain Waltrip?
Well, I don't know. Their car is running real good. We just have to take a look at it, Ken, see what it looks like. I don't know whether to try to, pass Darrell and go ahead and try to break away or sit here with him. I just have to see what happens the next few laps.
What about Terry Labonte in the 44? He's right there behind you, and that Dale Inman car has been a sleeper all week, Dale.
I just have to make a decision here next few laps.
Well, that's Cale Yarborough currently riding in second place. A year ago here on CBS, you saw him call his shot at this juncture of the race and go on to win the Daytona 500. It's a somewhat different situation this year with so many cars in the lead lap, so many people eligible, good candidates to win
so
it all.
So many good cars in the lead lap, too.
Here's Ned Jarrett.
Ken, we're still standing in Terry Labonte's pits. We're seeing Bob Labonte, who is Terry's father, standing with two tires up on pit wall, ready to change those tires. We speculated a moment ago that most of the top drivers would come in and put on four new tires. As we see, that didn't happen. It's been sort of a cat and mouse game down here. If Waltrip had come in, or if Cale had come in, then Labonte would have come in. They were prepared. Since they stayed out there, of course, the 44 car, the crew there chose for him to stay out there also, but they're still cocked and ready just in case in one of these laps that one of those decide that they want to dip down pit road and take on those fresh tires. Now, of course, Harry Dent, Neil Bonnet, and Bill Elliott all did come in and put on fresh tires. We'll see what kind of a difference that makes if the others don't come in.
180 laps, 20 laps to go, 50 miles when they come by this time, and there'll be at least one more caution. And the situation is this, not six, but seven cars are in the lead lap as Neil Bonnet stays there. Bonnet able to change rubber and get back out. And so as we stand now, number 11, Waltrip is in front, the Tennessee driver. Then comes Cale Yarborough second, Terry Labonte third, Dale Earnhardt is in fourth, Harry Gant is in fifth, Bill Elliott is in sixth, and going seventh is Neil Bonnet. Those are the front seven cars, all in the lead lap. And the laps, well, not many left, David.
Neil Bonnet, of course, and Bill Elliott could now turn into be really threats, having put on four new tires in that last pit stop. That is assuming the tires are right size and everything else that goes with it.
What we have here is a clash, as we saw 1 week ago live here on CBS. We have about 50 miles. It'll be at least another lap less than that. Remember that 20-lap sprint, which Neil Bonnet won last Sunday, as you saw it live here on CBS, in a dramatic finish.
He played that one right. Of course, obviously, they didn't change tires or anything, but he could have a distinct advantage starting off. And, of course, yesterday in the sportsman race, we saw Darrell Waltrip pull a win off. And at a pit stop just prior to that, he had changed his tires, and the other three drivers had not.
Here's Chris Economac.
Well, Neil Bonnet is 18th in line on the track right now, and in the same lap with the leaders, so it's coming down. His experience in traffic is going to come in handy here. If a rookie were in that position with a fast car, he'd have a lot of trouble. Bonnet has got to get through those slow pokes to get up and take a shot at the leaders. Another bit of trivia here, Cale Yarborough hasn't worn out a single tire today, but he's changed 16 of them. Back to you, Cam.
Now, there's the Neil Bonnet car. Line six on the field. Now, the lap cars will drop to the inside. Cars in the lead lap will pull plenty outside, and he is seventh. He is seventh on the field.
So he should start off in about seventh in the high lane. All the lap cars pulling down to the left-hand lane. But, of course, once the racing starts, they then tend to spread all over the track, and, of course, it does make it hard if you get behind some of them. And your immediate adversaries are pulling away with a clear track. One lap to go. Now we'll see Neil Bonnet start to pull up. Make ground on the leaders in that top line. Cale Yarborough right behind Darrell Waltrip.
Getting ready for green next time by. Cale Yarborough, how does one feel when you get out of a race car after 500 miles?
Well, you feel like a Mack truck or something's run over you. You're real exhausted and you know, because you have to give 100% physically and mentally for 500 miles, and it just drains you dry. It takes you about a week to get over one.
When they come by and take green, 182 laps will have been completed, and there will remain 18 to go, 45 miles. Seven cars in the lead lap. Back in the eighth spot is Jeff Bodine in the five car. In the ninth position is Ricky Rudd. What a comeback after that horrendous wreck he had a week ago. The 10th car, the top rookie here, is Phil Parsons. In the 11th position is Pearson. The 12th position is Ridley. 13th is Reagan. 14th is Sterling Marlin. 15th is Pond. 16th is Mike Alexander. 17th is Jimmy Means. Dean Roper is 18th. Greg Sachs is 19th. And Dean Combs is 20th. With Heverin 21st. Clark 22nd. Connie Saylor 23rd. As they get ready to put the green flag back on it and sprint to the finish.
It is a sprint, too. 19 laps. 18 laps. Just coming up.
Waltrip to the line.
start there, leaving everybody else way behind, and David Pearson from the lower row slotting in behind him.
Waltrip first. There's Pearson right there. Remember that Pearson...
But look at Cale Yarborough, eat them up. Just look at him coming off turn two.
Pearson, the 16 car, running 11th. Here comes Yarborough by the Silver Fox, chasing the two-time champion, Darrell Waltrip, into turn three.
How depressing for everybody else. He must have been 50 yards behind just after they crossed the line.
Reeling in Waltrip, Yarborough at the tri-oval, and there are 17 to go. And on the move comes Bonnet. You see him trying to drop inside. Staying third is Terry Labonte. Maintaining fourth is Dale Earnhardt. There are your leaders. Darrell Waltrip, who is now making his 12th effort at winning the Daytona 500. 79, he finished second when Donnie Allison and Cale Yarborough crashed right here in the back straightaway. And Richard Petty came home the winner. Darrell was second, A.J. Foyt third. Foyt, one of the early retirees today. Out of four, Waltrip. Look at his hand shuffle on the top of the wheel as he tries to maintain the pace at some 190 miles per hour. And Yarborough hitchhiking on the rear bumper.
Well, of course, at this stage, you've got to ask yourself whether, in fact, he wants to leave now before the last lap, having seen the leader in the last two major races, he'll lose out on the last lap. Darrell also will be feeling the same.
We've had a lot of pyrotechnics in the last laps here at Daytona, and we may be getting set for one again. Now, let's go back to third place. There you see, number 44 in third, Labonte in fourth. That is Earnhardt, and in fifth is number 33, Gant, and in sixth, Neil Bonnet. In seventh, number nine, Bill Elliott. Here's Bonnet closing on Harry Gant. Tri-oval. Now 185 laps complete, 15 to go. If we get out of this without some paint missing and some fenders flailed, it'll be a bit of a surprise, David. Getting down to show and tell time in the 1984 Daytona 500. We'll bring it all to you after these messages. We'll be with you straight through to the checkered flag from here in our CBS live coverage of the 1984 Daytona 500. One change of position. Bonnet has pulled up past Harry Gant. He has gone to fifth. Gant is to sixth. Elliott is in seventh. Seven cars in a bundle. Laps trickling away. Waltrip first. Yarborough second. Terry Labonte stays third. And they're all back together as they come out of turn four. Seven drivers vying to win the Daytona 500.
Seven drivers covered by 0.7 of a second, any one of which could win this race.
Cale Yarborough, second place, down into turn one. Probably saving it. Wanting to use Waltrip for a slingshot at the end. They may start getting aggressive here.
Waltrip not knowing quite what to do, whether to stay in the lead. He can't back out of it. He might slip to the back of the bunch. Neil Bonnet, who is near the back, he's running his best spot. Just a bit nearer the front than this to make a go on the last.
Now here to the inside, pulling up one. That's Earnhardt going to third, pulling up into fourth, taking a spot. It is Neil Bonnet, and here comes Gantry, and they get through. And dropping back into the sixth position goes Terry Labonte.
Terry Labonte been a little bit wide, going through turns three and four.
Neil Bonnet, how do you know where to go in a shootout at the finish line at Daytona?
If I come down to the end of the wire, Daytona 500, I can't say, look, I want to possibly do this, I possibly do that. I'm going to have to work off split-second instinct. I'm either going to be the biggest hero you ever saw or the biggest dummy.
Down to decision time. Terry Labonte has scraped the wall with number 44. He's falling off the pace. The Dale Inman crew, the Billy Hagan car, number 44, has just touched the wall, and he's down on the apron. No caution.
He must have had a problem with his car because he went very wide in turns three and four the lap before that, so maybe he had a tire going away or something.
Now there were six.
Well, that's bad luck on Terry Labonte. Really is. He drives so well, and he just doesn't seem to be able to win one of these big races.
When they come by this time, there will be 8 laps to go. $1 million at stake. Here's Terry Labonte on pit road.
There's the side of the car that's all scraped on that wall.
What a sad moment for the Texan, Terry Labonte, who has driven such a great race today. Something had to be amiss. Yarborough still in second, holding on to Darrell Waltrip. Here is Neil Bonnett, maintaining fourth position. A quick word from Ned Jarrett.
They are changing the right side tires, pulling any fender metal away from the tires, Ken, but as you say, this is taking them out of the possibility of winning this race. It would take, well, the leaders are going by now, so they're going a lap down. They got a problem over there, so too bad for Terry Labonte.
The Daytona 500 ending in a thundering crescendo among six great drivers, six great teams. Hate to see anybody lose out of this group, but you'll only remember the winner. Here they are, back straightaway. Yarborough just sitting there. Earnhardt with the Richard Childress car doing a marvelous job in third, and now down to the inside, Harry Gant sneaking a peek at fourth position. Neil Bonnett. If they lock up side by side, those front three could pull away. Here comes Gant.
Gant trying the low line there underneath Neil Bonnett, who went around the outside of him there in the same place about 3 laps before.
Tucks back in. Yarborough still waiting. Inside pass, outside pass. Going into 3, coming out of 4, coming to the tri-oval. Where will it happen? They love 3. Waltrip is using up a lot of racetrack. Yarborough, he's sizing things up, deciding where he wants to take that shot. Remember, 79 right there. That's where it happened. Cale Yarborough and Donnie Allison crashing, spinning right into the wall right here, and setting up a win for Richard Petty, number 6 in the 500. Out of 4. Well, they may be down in the grass. They may be up on the wall. 194 laps, as you see it, from the Goodyear Blimp Enterprise have now been completed. There are 6 laps to go. 6 great drivers. Each of them confident they can do it. If they didn't have that confidence, they wouldn't be in those chairs.
Single file around turn 2 as they swoop down that back stretch. Fastest mile on this course. Up to speeds of over 200 miles an hour. Cale Yarborough making a bit of a move on Darrell Waltrip right behind him. Dale Earnhardt coming up.
Final thought from Ned Jarrett.
We're with Jeff Hammond, Walter's crew chief. Jeff, he's been leading this thing. Is he where he wants to be now as you get down to the end?
Well, as he told me a little while ago on the radio, Ned, he said
he's hearing from Darrell.
And he's going to try to feel the guys out, and he's got to pick the best place. He really don't know himself.
Okay, you can see that he was listening to Darrell on one ear and trying to talk to us on the other, that he was going to feel out the competition. He doesn't really know where he wants to be. Now let's go down to Chrissy Conimax and see if what Cale Yarborough thoughts are.
Waddell, is Cale where you want him to be and where he wants to be right now?
Well, the last caution, he told me that that's where he wanted to be, is in second place, and it seems to work in second. In the Busch race, you know, he's third and ended up second. And the second place man won that race, so we just have to, you know, wait and see what he decides to do, because he's the one that knows what the car is doing and what he's capable of doing.
What's he saying?
He isn't saying anything right now.
Okay, back to you, Ken.
Coming by, 196 laps will be complete. There will be 4 laps to go.
Another go to try and get around the underneath of Neil Bonnett. Neil Bonnett having nothing of it. These cars are so evenly matched. And there's going to be 6 very disappointed people out here in just a few minutes. There's going to be 5 disappointed people out there in just a few minutes. In about 3.5 minutes.
Waltrip reels off the laps.
That's the sort of thing that can catch all your plans. You can lay plans all day, and then a guy like that, number 41, Ronnie Thomas, can be right where you want to be on the last lap, and the whole thing's history.
And yet you know that the leader is sizing up those lap cars, looking around that track, keeping track of them to try and contain those men behind him. And you know, as you look out at Cale Yarborough's car, that he would give anything if that butterfly had wings that could really fly. Anything to help here.
I think the lap car they're about to go around here is probably the last obstacle before the end of the race for them. There is another lap car, but I don't think they'll make it to him.
Last lap at 190 miles per hour, and they've really slowed the pace down. They're at 190. Back straightaway. There's Clark Dwyer's number 17 being passed. The field goes back into three. Yarborough closes up. Not much of a hole on the inside. If he wants to go, he's got to go around.
The pace has gone down mainly because Darrell Walsh, if rather...
Here comes Bonnet.
And he can slip back to second spot, I would imagine.
Bonnet trying to move through. No, thank you. Fourth, Bonnet. Two to go. 5 miles remaining for $1 million purse. Lion's share. It gets divided among all of them, of course. Here is Yarborough. There is Bonnet. Line fourth, right behind Earnhardt, who's had a marvelous day. White flag. Next time by. Over 100,000, they say over 130,000 coming to their feet. They sense this could be the one to remember. It was fantastic in 76 when Pearson won it over Petty. It was great in 79 when Petty came back. Last year, Cale Yarborough with an amazing move in the last lap to set down Baker, and Bill Elliott came home in second place. This is it, the last lap of the Great American Race. Waltrip still deployed first. Yarborough in second. Yarborough edges to the outside. Back straightaway, final time. Down to the inside. The move he loves. Here he comes up to the inside. It is Cale Yarborough taking first as they get into turn number three, coming for four. Down to the inside. Here comes Earnhardt. Earnhardt trying for second. Trying to find a place to run. They're coming to the finish line. At the line, it is Cale Yarborough. He's done it again.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord. Cale Yarborough crossing the line, winning back-to-back as the first man since the late Fireball Roberts to win a Daytona Triple Crown.
Darrell Walsh in field now. Not only lost second place, he lost second place as well.
Earnhardt pulled up to congratulate him and wave to him. It's over. A marvelous race. And again, the executor in the back straightaway. Cale Yarborough, this must be a thrill. What a great maneuver on that car. Had such incredible power today.
Well, this car really ran good today, as far as can't ever think this went real good. And, you know, this was... Wish everybody a happy journey home. We got a good crowd here today, and hope to be seeing them again soon. Thanks, Lord, for a good, safe race.
And of course, it's on to Richmond, Virginia for you next Sunday, a half mile, then Rockingham. Weren't you worried about those guys out back?
Well, yeah, I was a little bit worried, but I figured if I could get the right shot at them, I thought I had to beef under the hood here to do it with.
Well, here he is coming down onto pit road, waving off those who try to go back to the garage area, and one car alone, getting the accolades of the pit crew. We have a photo finish to look at for second place, and the various pit crews all applauding as Cale comes by, having won, and you can hear the crowd now overcoming the engine noise. Look at this battle for second place. That's Earnhardt in the yellow car on the inside, Darrell Waltrip on the outside, first across the line, Yarborough, and it is Dale Earnhardt for second place. And now you are driving to the most hallowed piece of turf in stock car racing. You are driving into victory lane at the Daytona International Speedway. There's Ned Jarrett standing by. Some 100, 150 photographers just to the right, waiting to all get pictures for newspapers around the world of this man, Cale Yarborough. He is with Ned Jarrett.
He's trying to get his safety paraphernalia unbuckled. Cale, another super run, if we can get a word from you here, buddy.
Well, thank you, Ned. I'll tell you, this Hardy Chevrolet just did a fantastic job. Waddell just had the car working so good. We never had any problems whatsoever, and you know, all I could do was drive it and just went to the front.
Well, you got that move down pat.
I've been working on it a long time, then.
Well, it certainly has, Ken. And I'll tell you, when you work on it that long and a man of perfection that he is, it results in being in victory lane.
This one's already set. Since 1962, he has come to Daytona. Let's look again at the pass for the lead as Cale Yarborough gets out of the saddle after this great victory. Here is the pass that gave him the 26th annual Daytona 500. Garrow Waltrip on the outside.
Well, that Waddell Wilson engine in that car of Cale Yarborough just seems to have that much more horsepower than anybody else. Darrell Waltrip must have been sitting there just, well, pig sick, because it's just inevitable the whole week, the whole 2 weeks, that was going to happen, and it sure did.
Look at Bill Elliott giving his all again on the outside in his car in the back of that picture.
Darrell Waltrip was giving his all, too. If you saw his arms through the going like windmills as he crossed the line.
Talk about heart. Let's go to Chris Economaki with Darrell Waltrip.
Well, Darrell, that had to be a tough last lap for you. What can a guy do at this racetrack when he's in the front on the last lap?
Well, you know, you got no chance, so you might as well, if I'm going to have to get smoked off, I'm going to be in the front. I couldn't pass him if I was behind him, so why follow him? I decided to stay in front. Who knows? Maybe he got sideways. Maybe the thing would have skipped a little bit, or something would have happened, and I could have beat him. But I knew what was going to happen, and, you know, I didn't see no need in getting all upset about it.
Okay. Better like next time, Darrell. Ken?
Average speed, 150 miles per hour, as Cale Yarborough is victorious, defeating at the finish line Dale Earnhardt, with the third spot coming to Darrell Waltrip. Fourth at the line today was that car number 12 that just hung in there, Neil Bonnet. And fifth, as we got down to the finish, was Bill Elliott. The L.A. Open follows here on CBS this afternoon. For Mike Joy, Chris Economaki, Ned Jarrett, David Hobbs, I'm Ken Squire. That's the story of the 1984 Daytona 500.
This CBS Sports Special has been sponsored by Pontiac. Cars that tell the world you're not just along for the ride. Pontiac, we build excitement. Skoal Bandits, for tobacco pleasure without lighting up. It's a pouch instead of a puff. Goodyear, makers of Vector, the new design in radial tires. And by Budweiser. For all you do, this Bud's for you.